31-year-old Muhammad Laho Yage Buhulel. From Tunisia, North Africa. Ran over and killed 83 people last night. He targeted a celebration he knew was full of men, women, and most importantly, children. And witnesses are reporting that he attempted to, like something out of a dystopic Road Warrior movie, target and run down the children. Will there be a Mad Max response to this? Certainly not. We'll be taught more sensitivity training. That's what the London mayor is calling for. You need to submit to the Muslims and they'll stop killing you. But don't worry. It's up on Infowars.com. Media blames truck, not terrorist or Islam, for the Nice attack. And we have CNN. We have the New York Times. When you go to CNN.com, like I did this morning, I took these screenshots and sent them to Watson. When you go and look at this, there were more than 15 articles I looked at scrolling down that said truck attack, truck maniac, man in truck goes berserk. No, it was a cold, calculated jihad attack on little children. Now, when a cop who's wrong or a cop who's in a bad situation or a cop who's psycho shoots some innocent person in the back, be they black or white, you're going to see it on the news. They're going to be personalized. One man dies is a tragedy. 10,000 dies is a statistic. But when Islam does this, you try to show the footage on Facebook, YouTube, you name it, they are shutting you down. But I've seen the footage. It was about 5:30. I'd just gotten home. I was walking in to say hi to my children. I'm sitting there in the parking lot of my house, in the driveway, and I go, I'm going to check InfoWars. And I go there, boom. Dozens run over in Nice. I go, okay, I know where to go to act to have something even ahead of us. This just happened 15 minutes ago. Boom, go to drugs. There's like 15 articles, everything. Bam, 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 bam. 50-something dead at that time. Now it's 80-plus. And I just turned the car around and drove right back over here to the office. We did 2 hours of InfoWars Nightly News live and then aired the news after that. As I said months ago, as I said years ago, And it's kind of a sick feeling to see Bill O'Reilly now picking it up and Newt Gingrich, because they're usually so wrong, but they're totally right this time. This is a war against the West. This is a slow motion Tet offensive, or Tet 2, as we've been warning you. And this is only the beginning. You notice the attacks are getting bigger and they're getting closer together. And France is close to 30% Islamic now. A lot of folks are converting under pressure. They're not going to go back. You can't deport them without a civil war. France is gone. It's gone. England is almost gone. The mayor has declared it's an Islamic city. He said, we don't care about Brexit. We're staying with the EU. That's opened the borders to Islam's invasion. The EU bureaucrats have allied with Islam. That is not rhetoric. This is actually happening. And I used to hear this from Pentagon people 15 years ago, and I'd say, you guys are paranoid. It's crazy. You know, this clash of civilizations is bad news. You're going to stir this up. Well, the Pentagon's not bad. They're the ones fighting it. But the globalists above it are the ones that have stirred it up. And let me tell you, it's on. You're going to see more and more of these attacks. They're going to get more and more frequent. And it was incredible last night. We have it in live time video during the broadcast, trying to upload videos that we'd shot live sections. Facebook would not let you put in any words about Islamic terror, anything in the descriptions in live time, just wouldn't let you put it. So it's not just the president tells you what words to use now, and no one will say Islamic terror. Now they won't let you, just like an iPhone won't let you say a cuss word or whatever. You try to say the F word, it puts the word duck in. Now the AI is controlling everything in live time. This is information warfare against us. The globalist are setting up a planetary system of total control. They are allied with the communist Chinese and with the Islamicist in the Middle East, run by the Saudi Arabian Wahhabist. If you control China with 1.3 billion people, you control the economic destiny of the world, and now to a great extent, the military destiny, and the power is being transferred in a double cross by the globalists to China. That is my own analysis. I've been studying it for decades. Undoubtedly, the transfer is being made long term, probably 20, 30 years. But the transfer is being made. The globalists have admitted that. They call it the Chinese century. What it is the dehumanization century, the new century of total tyranny. But if you control the Middle East with the Wahhabist and Saudi Arabia that's geographically right in the middle, and you control 80% of Islam that is Sunni-based, that again comes right out of Saudi Arabia, you can then control East Asia, Central Asia, Eurasia, Eastern Europe, much of Northern Africa, Eastern Africa, down into Central Africa. And then we've got Islamic seed pods, invasion ships. I mean, that's what this is like, is an alien invasion, folks. Being set down in all our major cities. They're buying off our leadership. They're moving in with political correctness to censor our speech. They're installing their Islamic mayors. This is not just a clash of civilizations. The deal's been made to kill the West and to shut down true liberalism. And it's being orchestrated by the so-called liberals, who are nothing but corporate fascist. A lot of real liberals and academics would call them neoliberals. But this is very, very serious. And they've moved their timetable up because they know Europe's waking up to globalism. Africa's waking up to globalism. Latin America's waking up to globalism. The different sectors of Asia are waking up to globalism. Russia is in full resistance to globalism right now. That does not mean Russia isn't a predator group and doesn't have its own corruption, but it's old-fashioned, male-driven, strongman, gangster stuff. It's completely different than what we are dealing with right now. We're dealing with globalists launching an AI takeover. The Russians are banning GMO, throwing it out of their country, saying it's a genetic takeover, economic warfare, saying carbon taxes are a world government takeover meant to destroy the nation state and the family and bring down the West. Say what you want about the Russians. By the month, they become this broadcast. And it's been articles written that, like, Russian leadership's turning into Alex Jones. Nobody's turning into Alex Jones, okay? I have eyeballs. I know what's going on. I have a brain. I'm seeing the same thing Russia's seeing. You'd have to be a moron not to see it. And I'm not lionizing Russia in this whole thing. I'm explaining to you they're paying people to have kids. They're exposing world government. They're blocking the anti-family agenda. They are exposing the radical jihad forces of Saudi Arabia being funded by the traitors that have taken over our nations. So that's basically how the chess pieces sit. The Navy SEAL, the best-selling author, the researcher, who's a very humble man, but came highly recommended by people I trust at the Pentagon, Mr. Bracken, is going to be joining us. He warned 2 years ago of the Tet 2 offensive that he believed would start being launched in 2016, an Islamic Tet offensive. And it's definitely here now. We have told you this is a war on Western civilization. Now that's been adopted by Newt Gingrich, Bill O'Reilly, and Fox News. Again, not bragging. We're just pointing out we know what we're dealing with. CNN, MSNBC, ABC News, The New York Times, all of them will not say Islamic terror. And our article is up on Infowars.com. It needs to go viral. Media blames truck, not terrorist or Islam, for the Nice attack that's killed 83 with more than 50 fighting for their lives right now. And a man on a motorcycle tried to drive up to the side and climb in and stop him a la Road Warrior and got killed. There were a lot of heroes over there and a lot of men that tried to get into the truck, but they were shot by this guy. Oh, you have total gun ban in France, but this guy had a gun. The jihadis always have a gun because they're bringing them in. Just like the last mastermind of the theater attack was a migrant whose new job, once he got into France a year before, was bringing in more migrants, just like the nightclub shooter at Pulse Nightclub. His father-in-law runs a major program bringing in the refugees, and there's a new story out at Infowars.com. It's from Breitbart.com. Hillary wants to bring in 1 million, quote, Islamic refugees in the first year. See, This is how it always works. They tell you it's 10,000, it's 100,000. When they tell you it's 100,000, it's a million. When they tell you it's a million, it's 5 million. We've seen the metric in Europe. Just 2 years ago, they were saying it was 100,000. It was 2 million then. It's 5 million now admitted. Comprende? And folks, they are bringing in military age men in every photo, in every video, in NATO and Interpol's own admissions. 80% are military age men, and almost all of the Syrian passports are fake, and they're just let in. They're not Syrians. These are the invasion force that entered Syria, like the Huns or the Mongols. You have the military force goes in with these Sunni invasions. They've done it all over the Middle East. 115 years ago, in 1901, the House of Saud controlled 200 square miles in the middle of Saudi Arabia. A few years later, they controlled all of Saudi Arabia. By 1933, they had control of the entire Middle East. This is what they do. They go in with the forces, and behind them come the men, women, and the children. Like locusts, they just steal everything, murder everyone, with Hillary funding them, with all the sick, weird, freakazoid Hillary supporters just loving it. And, oh, Christians are being murdered? Good. These are evil people that know they're allied with their muscle. And they hate America and the free market and the Second Amendment so much, the average liberal I've talked to actually knows this and can't wait to see the West fall. These are the anti-liberals. And as an enemy, they call themselves liberals. You've got to understand this, folks. Everything is upside down. Liberal means you keep more money. Liberal means you can raise your children as you see fit. Liberal means you have private property rights. Liberal means you can practice whatever religion you want as long as you don't harm others. Liberal means you can live your own life and have a right to self-defense. That's liberal. Real feminism is a woman being able to be armed and protecting herself. Under the state-run feminism, it's incredibly weak, chip on the shoulder women whose husband is the state. Now, I'm going to go over these numbers. I'm going to talk about this. We have the picture of this individual now, the first supposed image of him, and we'll put that up on screen from his ID. They're calling him a Frenchman who's from Tunisia. And he's a madman on a rampage with a 18-wheeler. No, he is an Islamicist. So here, I'll just go to Drudge Report right here. And I'll go right here where it says first photos of the individual. And we'll just click on that. And everybody can then see what the fella looks like. But continuing here, ladies and gentlemen, we have the media, again, trying to spin all of this and behave like it's not another Islamic attack. But the big issue here is for everyone to understand there is a method to this madness. They intend to let these people attack. They intend to condition us to allow them to attack. They intend to encourage more attacks. They intend to bring in larger numbers and then make you conform and go to Islamic sensitivity training at all high schools and all colleges, already being put in place right now at, quote, Muslim camps, to learn that your speech can incite them and you must submit to their strictures. And that's what the London mayor is doing. He says, I'm not going to be an Uncle Tom. I'm going to be proud of my Islamic background, and we're going to enforce it, and you're not going to have women on the buses or city-owned buildings in bathing suits. See, Sharia law. And then, oh, he wants more money for security measures to shut down everybody else's free speech, but let people run around with ISIS flags on the streets in London. But if I or Paul Watson or others go out and even try to videotape or talk to people, the cops run over and act like we are the Antichrist. So this is their plan. And they are planning to let these attacks intensify and get worse and worse and worse. And you see the mainstream media, you see the corporate governance systems, you see all of these different forces working together in unison, working together as one unified system of total war to not even tell you that it's an Islamic attack or an Islamic invasion, and they won't even tell you what the true numbers are. They won't even let you know how many people have been brought in. And when they attack, they say U.S. citizens did it, even when the woman in San Bernardino wasn't. And for 2 days, they ordered the FBI to say it wasn't Islamic. It wasn't a terror attack. It was workplace violence. And they have Facebook, and they have Google, and they have Twitter, all censoring people that even mildly report on it. And now we have a video coming up for TV viewers, radio listeners, I'll describe it. We're not even on Facebook able to put in the word Islamic in the keywords under our reports or in the headlines. The video's up on Infowars.com. Facebook caught censoring words, Islamic terror during niche attack. World's largest social media site assist in controlling the narrative. We need to write a bigger article about this and actually have screenshots for folks. We have the video, but screenshots, people understand. We have video. Facebook caught on video censoring words Islamic terror, working to allow the invasion to intensify. They are accelerating the Islamists being brought in. They are bringing in people from Sunni-held radical areas that failed in their invasion so far, partially of Syria. They're now being brought in through Turkey. They're then being flown in by the State Department and by the Pentagon to bases everywhere. They are now, you go to a park in Austin, you go to a doctor's office, you go to a, it is all of a sudden women in burqas all over the place. The numbers must be gigantic. My high school last year got 200 and what is it, 30 plus people. And then we called the other high schools. They all had similar numbers. The elementary schools wouldn't give us the number. They claim 100 have come to Austin total. These are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of children per school. Then you've got the open Latin American border and the Chinese flowing in. And they're all being put directly on the Democratic Party mammary gland. They're being inducted in as the army of the socialist and the big mega corporations that control them to bring down the nation. This is so incredible. And then the news won't let you see the children being run over and won't even let you see their dead little bodies. But you better believe when a cop does something wrong or makes a mistake, you're going to see it everywhere because they want the war to be on the local government that they know the globalists don't completely control. Doesn't mean local government's perfect. God, no. But it's our local government. Police arrest Bastille Day killer's wife as dramatic footage shows moment. Muhammad, that's his name, was shot dead in the truck he used to drive through crowds, killing 84 people, including 10 children. Warning graphic content, but everybody needs to go look at this and look at it real good and understand it's being seen in some of the European press. They are blocking it out here. Of course, first thing we said last night during 2 hours of live coverage was, are we going to have a 5-day waiting period on trucks? Are we going to have maybe safety locks on trucks? Maybe the answer is they have to all be computer robot driven. Oh, but then somebody will hack that because you can't trust humans to drive because, hey, the truck did it. We need Truck Control Incorporated. Maybe we should sue the truck manufacturers like you sue gun manufacturers. And you know what? Find out the maker of the truck. That'd be like suing Boeing because, you know, one of their aircraft was used on 9/11. You say, Alex, this is satire. This is ridiculous. Yeah, it's ridiculous to sue Bushmaster because the supposed shooter in Newtown got one illegally from someone else who got it legally and went and reportedly shot people. I don't know what happened. I just know Anderson Cooper's on green screen saying he's there and they're walking in circles in and out of the building with a chopper over it. And I know an FBI agent, current FBI agent, who thinks it's all bull. And then Rob Dews' uncle, former Navy SEAL, FBI current agent. We were up there to cover Newtown, and guess who was there? City Council. Why, his uncle. And his uncle said, this thing's the craziest thing I've ever seen. I don't believe any of it, but I can't talk to you about it. He was there for the FBI looking at it. Understand, folks, I don't know what went on there. They go, oh, you say no children died. You say no. All I know is I know a $3 bill when I see one, and it isn't real. I don't know what happened, but I know something really stinks. Kind of like you go in your house, and you've been out of town for a week, and it stinks horribly, and you go, I don't know what dead animal, you know, is up there in the attic, but, boy, I'm going to go up there with a bag and a shovel, and I'm going to, oh, yeah, it's a dead possum. You know, I don't know what's up there, but it stinks to high heaven. So we know two FBI agents that one of them I just named that say it's the phoniest thing they've ever seen, and so many others. But I'm digressing. This is real. This happened because it is a false flag, though, in that the globalists are bringing them in, letting them get weapons, letting them attack, and then blaming all of our rights, saying we've got to give our liberties up, and we've got to be nicer to the immigrants. It's our fault that they're killing us. How do you pronounce this guy's name? 31-year-old Muhammad Lahoyej Bouhoulil. And this guy's from Tunisia, North Africa. And he comes in, and he's sitting there in France in the lap of luxury, totally pissed off on the national holiday, the 4th of July of France, Bastille Day. So the coward, the filth, goes out and targets a nighttime picnic with the street closed, with kids in their pajamas out watching fireworks, and he runs over hundreds of people, killing 83. What a man. What a great guy. What a fantastic person. Can you imagine if there was footage, and certainly our troops have done things that are wrong, and the droning and all the things that Obama does are wrong. That's okay because he's liberal. Can you imagine if, say, a special forces soldier, active duty, ran over over 150 people, killing 83 of them, including children, and then no one in our military or our government said they were a killer or a scumbag or psychotic? No, of course they would. But where's the Islamic groups apologizing? They don't have to, and they're not going to, because the media will not say Islamic, because this media is literally, I overuse that word because it's the only word that, when I say literally, they are literally running a program to flood us, to cover it up, to work with the enemy, because they're the enemy, and to merge with their foot soldiers, their national security force, all over Europe, all over the UK. They are putting Islamicists in charge as the police chiefs, as the mayors, and they are taking people's kids with CPS. I've had members of Parliament on who are liberals saying it's true. We hire mainly Eastern Europeans that come from communist countries and Muslims, and they don't even speak English, and they're taking everybody's kids for no reason. And someone just shows up and can't even speak English, just blah, 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 and just drags you off. That's who the socialists and the government want, is a kept group that they control, that they can use as a weapon anytime they want. Now, when we come back, do I need to play the imam saying we're invading Europe, we're going to get your women? I mean, the main imam of Jerusalem. Do I need to play all the moderate Muslim leaders in the U.S. saying we're going to kill the homosexuals as a blessing to them? We're going to murder you. You know, the guy at his mosque in Florida. And the media says, oh, you're allowed to do that. Oh, really? Telling your flock, go out and kill people. And now they have a new Pew Research poll out. In France, 18 to 29 support suicide bombing. 18 to 29. In that demographic, 35% in France Oh, my gosh. I'm reading that wrong. It's worse than I said. All Muslims polled at all ages of 35%. 18 to 29 is worse. It's 42% in France. Excuse me. 42% of military-age males in France, 42% want to kill you when they're asked. They're very proud of it. That's why they want to apologize for these bombings. They're very proud of it. Spain, 29% are proud to kill you and your family and run over your kids. And I'm sure the average liberal will probably start lining their kids up like bowling pins. It'd be a new sport where liberals bring their kids out and Muslims run over them. I'm not kidding. I think if you actually, they told liberals to take their kids out in the middle of the street and have a Muslim run over them, they'd put their kid's head under the tire and
we're
say,
on the march.
Kill my kid. I'm telling you.
On the
I'm
run.
Telling you.
Alex
I'm telling
Jones
you.
And the GCN Radio
These
Network.
Are psychotic demons. So I want to be clear. I have made 5 films concerning what really happened on 9/11. It has now been declassified. It has now been leaked that everything I put in those films has now been proven to be accurate. And the reason it's accurate is almost everything was already in the congressional report that was out in the first year. We had all the whistleblowers on. We know what happened to a great extent on 9/11. And criminal elements of our government, bare minimum, stood down so Saudi Arabia could run the attacks. Now, you expand out from there. Their operatives were probably decoys. There were other aircraft. It gets crazy. Flight 93 was shot down. We even know who did that. The Air National Guard. We even have the recordings of the 2 AIM-9s put into the aircraft. This is a serious situation. And it was meant to start a clash of civilizations between the West and Islam and give the United States the pretext to be able to basically take over the Middle East, control the grand chessboard, as Brzezinski writes, because if you control the Middle East, you control Africa below it. You control all of Asia to the east, Russia to the north, Eastern Europe, and Europe to the west. And that is the geopolitical strategy and stratagem that has been adopted as the globalist NATO program. And Russia talks a lot about this. I was against that because it was immoral. Okay. And because we were targeting Muslim countries that were not our enemies. And by that, we were going after moderates like Saddam Hussein and Gaddafi, and then later our allies in Egypt, and really doing some bad stuff. I mean, Saddam was put in there by the CIA to kick the Islamists' butt in an earlier program under Eisenhower. But that's a story for another day. He was totally set up. I mean, I'll say it, compared to Al-Qaeda, the guy deserves the Congressional Medal of Honor or something. All the stuff Saddam did, killing communists and trying to take out people and finally overthrowing the Ba'athist and then taking it over for the United States and actually having a policy of stabilizing and building up Iraq. And then our U.S. policy that was very moral changed in the 1980s when Herbert Walker Bush started running the show. And again, Saddam was a thug and did a lot of bad things. I'm saying compared to Al-Qaeda. It was his arch enemy. That's why Trump came out and said, Saddam Hussein sure was good at killing terrorists compared to our president. And they said, oh, you love Saddam. And he goes, well, no, he was a bad guy, but all I'm saying is he was good at killing terrorists. Trump knows that he was a CIA officer. Trump knows he was set up, okay? I mean, Saddam Hussein was totally set up, ladies and gentlemen, told to invade Kuwait. Okay, I'm going off on a jag. He had rock and roll on the radio and Playboy sold in shops. And I'm not saying that's even good, but that's why the Islamists hated his guts so much. He couldn't stand them. He couldn't stand them. He was trained in the West. He was sent in there to westernize the Middle East. But that policy ended by the 70s, late 70s. And they decided to go with the jihadis and the Saudi Arabians. And the State Department started sending textbooks into the madrasas, radicalizing them. Billions have been spent a year by the West to radicalize what is in Islam and to make the most radical forms the dominant form so Saudi Arabia could take over. And that's the new plan, and that's what we're under right now. And so I was against going in there because I smelled a rat. I mean, I knew it was a quasi-false flag. I knew that Saudi Arabia was involved. But what was their payoff? What you see now, the whole Middle East, the whole region, that's why McCain's involved, the neocons. Obama's running a neocon strategy. This is the same stuff we've seen before. And who are the neocons? You want to talk about immoral and evil and Machiavellian. They are the Trotskyites, the founder of the neocons. Was the adjunct of Trotsky, killed in Mexico City. And then they merged with the Straussian School of Economics at Chicago Business School, who was a Nazi, and they went right wing. And I mean, you talk about whacked out, man. You talk about whacked out. They say you're anti-Semitic if you talk about how a lot of the neocons were Jewish. These people, I mean, you can have a serial killer, you know, Jeffrey Dahmer. What last name is that? You say the whoever those are, you know, somebody has the name Smith. You can say English people are evil. No, they weren't Jews. Some of them were happened to be Jews, but the point was they were communists, they were Nazis, they were whatever gets them power. If it means being Republicans, they're for that. And they are allied with Saudi Arabia, who is absolutely, totally, and completely evil. Just like the globalists, who are a bunch of different groups, are allied with communist China, there is no race component to this at the bottom of the rabbit hole. It is just raw power, raw control, a race to merge with machines and become gods, to quote Ray Kurzweil. That's what's going on here. Now, I want to drill into what's happened. I want to tell you about some of the guests that are coming up today. Former Navy SEAL Matt Bracken is going to be joining us. Paul Wass is going to be popping in. Jesse Ventura was already scheduled on the show. We'll be talking to him about the election and more. We have David Knight, Han Schoing, the fourth hour of Overdrive here today. But before I go any further, the big news out of the 83 dead and the hundreds wounded, 50-plus critical still, others dying every few hours, is the cold-blooded evil. In fact, will you guys in a little while queue up the new snake video that we updated? We should probably update it again. And I'm going to go over this list of Islamic terror in 2016. A shorter list is linked on drudgereport.com from infowars.com. I think I'm going to update the list because there's a full list that we also have on the site that shows the thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands dead just this year from Islamic terror. You think 200 and something is bad in France in the last year? Wait till you've got a concentration of, say, 80% Muslims or 100%, because when they hit 100%, they all start killing each other because that's what they do when it's this virulent strain of Islamic garbage. And you can say, well, it's radical, or, oh, is it orthodox? Whatever, the dominant form of Islam, funded by Saudi Arabia, backed by our government and the traitors in our media, that won't even tell you it's Islamic. You think about that. Our government is 110% illegitimate. You've got the leftist, the Obama people, the neocons, and others. Just a consortium of criminals that have been bought off basically by Saudi Arabian money and have made a deal with Saudi Arabia and a deal with Islam that will Islamify the world basically completely within 30 to 50 years, most estimates show, and the globalists don't care. They're intending to actually merge with this thing. It take me back to the Lord of the Rings when you got Gandalf up there with Saruman. And he says, we must join with Sauron. And he says, are you insane? Can't join with Sauron. And he's like, he's already moving in the east and into the west. We ought to cue that up later. I mean, you sit there and watch that. This isn't some allegory by J.R.R. Tolkien, who, by the way, was in World War I, and a lot of it is an allegory of World War I, but coming wars he saw with Islam. It's a Christian allegory. Oh, yes. That's recently his writings, they've held back, the left has been, and the family, it's been coming out. And I've had some of the top Tolkien experts on. Tolkien was an original info warrior. And all those different allegories, and you're seeing it now. You're absolutely getting front row seats to it, ladies and gentlemen. And the way this Islam is basically a satanic system. And it claims it's bringing all this tyranny to then normalize so you submit and are at peace, but they're never at peace. It's a bunch of bullies controlling and dominating society behind walled cities having homosexual orgies. But then if they catch an average person doing it, they execute you. It is just a 1984 world merged with a religion. It's a political ideology of dominance and control. A thug-driven system that has a religion to deliver it, its system around the planet. And Zuckerberg, remember a few months ago, was on a hot mic with Merkel. We've played it many times. And he said, don't worry, I'm going to start censoring. We've got a way to do this. Then he hired former members of the Stasi to track and report people that mildly criticize the open borders. And then the police come and arrest you. Just 2 years ago, it started out where they'd censor you on Facebook in Germany, in Sweden or France. Now they're arresting you. Well, it's already here now. Now we can't put in to the keywords Islamic terror or Islamic jihad or a whole bunch of other words. Facebook won't let you. They are burning books. It's beyond burning books. They're burning words. They're memory holding. I mean, this is beyond 1984. It all starts reasonable. Like, you want to send somebody a cuss word on your phone. I'm not a big cusser, but sometimes I send a text message to somebody saying, what the is this? And it says, what the duck? And it won't let you type what you want. You see? That's the nanny state. You're like, oh, well, that's a cuss word. You shouldn't be doing that. If you buy a so-called mini computer and you pay $500 for it, you should be able to do whatever you want with that phone in a literary way. It's yours, but see, it's not yours. It's not yours. It's loaded up with software that's going to train you that it controls your life, not you. And people are like, oh, well, that's just cuss words. Well, now you can't write it or publish it on the internet, you see. The words aren't even allowed. I was told a decade ago, before Shazam even existed, by radio execs, that in the future, they're going to have systems where they can go out with bots, and in a matter of hours, they can code key your voice and have your voice banned from the internet in a matter of hours. Erased, unreadable by devices, untransmittable. You think you've seen book burning by the Nazis. You think you've seen corruption. Ladies and gentlemen, you ain't seen nothing yet with these powers they're bringing in and citywide killing cell phone video cameras. And see, all of this, this is so draconian. And it will enslave all of us, whether you're a black man, a white man, Hispanic, a woman, an old person, whether you're a Muslim, whether you're a Christian, whether you're an agnostic, this tyranny that's coming in is history ending. That's what the globalists call it, the final revolution and the end of history. Go read it. Where everything's going to be micromanaged by computers, run by them, the language reduced, you'll be dumbed down, entertained, drugged, stealth poisoned, killed, and no more humans. The public number is 250 million allowed to live. Look up the Ted Turner quotes. Look up the UN quotes. But you get a deeper research, they just say, no, we're going to merge with the machines. The new God will be created, and then we will be obsolete. And we might allow a few humans here and there, but they'll be like bugs. I'm giving you real quotes here. They'll be like insects. We might accidentally step on you. That's one of their favorite quotes, Kurzweil's and others. You know, we might let you live, but doesn't mean we might not just step on you because we won't even be paying attention to you. We're liberals. Bring in the Muslim hordes. Chop off the women's genitals. Murder the children. Blah, liberal. Blah, liberal. Blah, liberal. Blah. And just all these little passive, weird wimps, you know, out of our events and stuff. There's always weird women running up with feminists written on their face, screaming at our reporters. We've shown the videos going, how dare you be here? Donald Trump's evil. He wants to hurt Muslims. And then it's like, and it's a little weird 18-year-old woman with feminist written on her face crying for Muslims. She has Stockholm syndrome. Sorry, I'm not going to sexually mutilate you. Sorry, our ancestors created all this freedom. Sorry. Sorry for the electricity, baby. Sorry for your little smartphone right there. Sorry. In fact, I forget which video that is ours. We've got so many hundreds of hours. I mean, but repeatedly these people, old women, young women, they're always white. They run up, they go, you hate Islam. We're like, are you an Islam? Shut up, racist. And it's just like, because they can't admit they're wrong. They can't admit they're con. They can't admit they're mentally ill. So they will not let you know that it's an Islamic attack. And the New York Times and CNN and everybody else plays along with it. The story's on InfoWars.com. Now, let's play this report. This is Darren McBreen and Rob Jacobson. While we're live for 2 hours last night, they're grabbing clips of the live show and uploading it to Facebook, YouTube, Dailymotion, a bunch of other platforms, where we now reach more than 5 million people a day on our own platforms, video-wise. Just a little audience we hit, small part of it. And guess what? Facebook said, no, no, no. Let's show you if you're a radio listener. You can go to InfoWars.com. The videos are posted. But for TV viewers, you'll be able to see it. I'll describe it. They describe it. This is the live, active information war directed by the White House, by the globalists, by Zuckerberg, by the foreign governments, with Saudi Arabia and the Islamists in live time covering up the invasion. Here's the video.
Darren McBreen, InfoWars.com. We got breaking news. As you all know by now, there's been yet another terrorist attack, this time in Nice, France, by radical Muslim terrorists. And guess what? The Facebook censorship warriors have already begun. Now, Rob Jacobson and I, we are here. We have attempted to upload a Donald Trump video of Donald Trump warning the world of future terrorist attacks. And we tried to put in radical Muslim terrorist as a keyword into Facebook. Check out what happens when we try this.
When we attempt to put these video tags in, as you can see, we've had pretty simple words here, Nice, France, InfoWars, were able to be accepted. What happens is if I put something simple in...
Here, let me hold the mic so you can go ahead and type. So what he's doing is, so these are keywords so people can help. This helps them find the videos, right?
So I'm going to type the word in, terrorist, because that's the event. Now notice over here.
Muslims are not terrorists.
Now I cannot hit enter without it, so I don't want any of these. It will
hit pause, hit pause, hit pause. Hit pause, back it up 10 seconds. See, people accuse me sometimes of exaggerating. 100 times out of one, I'm not. All the time, it's like I was reading poll numbers of Muslims saying that they want to kill Westerners and agree with suicide bombing, and I was flipping the numbers. It was worse than what I was saying. See, it's like almost always I downgrade it because my mind can't believe it. I'd forgotten that they didn't just not let them type it. It gave them the message, Muslims are not terrorists, and told us to use that. I forgot. They're not just erasing words and language. They're replacing it in real time with what they want. See? This whole... Let's go out to break with the rest of the clip. Show people this. This is incredible.
Words so people can help. This helps them find the videos, right?
So I'm going to type the word in. Terrorist, because that's the event. Now notice over here,
Muslims are not terrorists.
Now I cannot hit enter without it, so I don't want any of these. It will not let me. It will only go with a suggestion that's on the list.
Now,
if I type in Muslim terrorists.
All right, folks, we're going to be right back.
Nothing comes up.
Full videos up on InfoWars.com. I mean, this is war against us. Our own government is against us with the Islamics. I mean, this is incredible. Against our free speech. We have our hacking writer, really an amazing individual, Mikhail Phelan, looking into it right now. But I have just learned information about Pokemon Go that is next level Big Brother. The total genius of this, it just completely blows me away. We are doing a report on it right now. It is going to be major news making. This is not in the news that we know of yet. It is unbelievable. Unbelievable. And by the end of the show, we should have a report out on this. This is crazy. This is unbelievable. Google isn't going to need trucks anymore and cars to drive around and get video of everything. It tells you where to go around and where to look for the so-called monsters, and really you're on a mission mapping everything for it. And you even got to target it and hold it right to get them the right footage of the little Pokemon. Doesn't stay on the spot you want. And you don't even know you're out droning, including inside your house for Google. That's the info. We're confirming it all right now. But, I mean, they just came out last year and, you know, they tell you, oh, the smart TVs are watching in your house. Yeah, we're selling the data. I mean, it's just like, wow, everything we said was true because we had the documents. Of course, I knew it was true. That was going on 15 years ago. I had engineers coming to me, and then I'd get death threats after it. I remember we got threatened by a big pharma company just like 6 years ago to be sued because we talked about their patents to have chips in the pills. And they said, that's not true. We're going to sue you. And now the company's come out with them. They just don't want it resisted before it becomes ubiquitous. I am so blown away right now. I mean, you can see how the technocracy is working. They're having congressional hearings about Facebook because they've been censoring conservatives. Forget conservatives. How about everybody? They won't let you say Islamic terror. And when you try to write that on Facebook, it comes back to you and says, there is no such thing as Islamic terror. Muslims are not terrorists. The sky is not blue. Obamacare is free. 2 + 2 = 5. You didn't build your business. And then you got Gruber on C-SPAN going, oh, thank God, the public's so dumb. Oh, I got help to rip everybody off. It's going to triple prices. I mean, what time zone or time warp did I enter, man, where the TVs are watching you, the Pokemon's a drone spy, they're bringing in radical Muslims of the worst type that just murder every other Muslim they get their hands on, and Christians, they... All these leftist gay groups love Muslims. I'm online saying, you know, bring more Muslims in so they can throw you off roofs. I mean, it's a freak show, man. It is a freak show. I'm going to stop right there. We need the funding to really get aggressive. Hillary's got a 30-mile exclusion zone at the RNC and DNC through Obama. They've never done that before, so we can't fly aircraft. We're going to do it outside the zone, other cities, but we're just getting a bunch of trucks now that have giant Hillary for President on the side for both events. So all the proceeds when you buy a Hillary for President shirt go to that, but don't let her stop you. You wear the shirt. You get in these people's faces. You explain to them how she's a fascist globalist and it's a takeover. Also, our top-of-the-line nutraceutical game changer that is proven to detoxify the cells. BioPQQ, CoQ10, resveratrol, you name it, it's the ultimate formula. It's a strong formula. Consult your physician before you take it. Some people have good side effects like getting numb and stuff where they've had nerve damage because it's one of the products you could say is patented to regrow nerves. I mean, this stuff isn't playing games. I chopped my finger off, 10 years ago, and the feeling never completely came back in. I started taking DNA Force, started tingling on the end. No longer numb, no longer, it's all there. Literally, 7-8 years after my finger was chopped off, the feeling came all the way back when I took DNA Force. Now, that's just what it does with nerves. Proven, documented, we can actually say it with this product because of the hundreds of studies and patents and everything else. InfoWarsLife.com, 25% off the regular price. Comparable products you get from doctors are 3, 4, 5 times. A lot of what's in it is prescription in Europe now. Get it, experience it, support the broadcast. You can't lose doing that. InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139.
Thank you for listening.
War's been declared on the West.
Visit GCN.
The technocracy's ally with Islam. Prepare yourselves. An imperial probe droid. Tell your children not to hear my word. But it's not the type we saw in the 1980 blockbuster Empire Strikes Back. It comes from the folks that own and run the most evil slave factories in the world. But they're liberals, so it's okay. Comes from the folks that symbol is the image of the fall of humanity. An apple with the bite out of it. And the other companies are just as bad, but they're the king daddy. You know, when you play, we're doing a report on this, nobody else has this info yet. Pokemon Go, it uses Google Maps to overlay where you're at. And now when you're in your house, you name it, all of it, you're just seeing the interface of the false reality, but videos being sent back to Google headquarters. So they know everything in your house. They know if you have a gun. They know everything you're doing. Because it's easy for you just to give a little high-tech imperial probe droid. Here, let me just give a probe droid that tracks everything my child does and even knows when they're asleep or when they're awake or what their heart rate is. It's just all in a little, you can talk to it. It's fun. They don't want to talk to you anymore, though. Here, have an imperial probe droid. It's like the Matrix. Oh, little spider legs come out of it and runs off. No, it's not scary like that. And the smart meter's running things and everything's fine. And, oh, Facebook won't let you say Islamic terror now. No, everything's fine. Everything's wonderful. Fantasy football's going to be coming up soon. For all the real men in America, you know, the real men, the Real men just give their kid an iPhone. You know, here you go. Play Pokemon over there. While the AI computer now has somebody with Google Maps to go around and add to their whole database. Thank you. Thank you for the intel. You thought you were playing a game. You're not playing a game. You're supper. You're in the game now. And then for folks that still get their news from CNN or the New York Times, Infowars.com, I cannot get over the fact that this is not bigger news. I cannot get over the fact that we broke last night to millions of people that watch Total. Hundreds of thousands watching on our streams, watching on television feeds. Hundreds of thousands watched on YouTube. Hundreds of thousands listened to the streams where we just sat there and showed everyone Facebook in live time won't let you say Islamic terror. And then changes what you write to Muslims are not terrorists. Doesn't just burn books. Doesn't just destroy language. It puts words in your mouth. It controls you. It engineers you. But that's okay because Mark Zuckerberg's a liberal. And he lives while you sleep, while you have the goggles on, the virtual reality that he controls. He walks bipedal like a man, like a god, amongst suboid slaves entering their matrix pods. And then you see where this technocracy is going. Just like Matt Drudge got told back in 2015 that 2016 was when they were going to roll out the real censorship, and Facebook brags we can deliver an election to whoever we want because, well, just like the voting machines change the vote for who you vote for, just like Hillary takes Bernie's votes. You're going to put up with it. Bernie supporters like me having their vote taken. Yeah, they like Hillary. Yeah. They like Zuckerberg. Zuckerberg says, yeah, our users trust us. They're dumb effers. Or if it was a smartphone that censors you, it'd be, they're dumb duckers. Because you can't say dumb effers. See, he's Mark Zuckerberg. He rules the biggest nation in the world, Facebook, with several billion users. And even CNBC says he's a dictator. But there's not going to be any news about him controlling language. Not going to be any news about the CIA already operating with thousands of fake reporters that are computers. Yeah, an actual agent might have pangs of guilt, but not the AI computer that's got a nice name. We're going to talk to our Navy SEAL friend who warned of this tattoo offensive coming several years ago. Mr. Bracken, straight ahead, Paul Watson, and more. The latest on the Nice Islamic terror attack. The orthodox, authorized, Islamic-supported jihad that our government won't tell you is. 31-year-old Muhammad Lahuyej Buhudel. He's got a lot of fans. They've got major polls out. They've got Gallup. They've got you name it. We were just showing some in the last hour. 35, 36, 37% in some areas, 42% in France of military age men want to kill and suicide bomb the French people. Now, that's asking somebody, do you want to kill people? Do you support this? And 42% of military age men say yes. When they polled Muslims in general, 36% in France. We showed that last hour. And it doesn't matter what polling agency you do, it's the same numbers. And it's similar in other nations because they're proud of it. It's why you're not going to see Muslims apologizing. Pew Research, 42% of military age men, 35% of Muslims, period, say they support suicide bombers. In Spain, 29%. In Great Britain, 35%. In Germany, 22%. In the United States, 26%. Support going out to their 4th of July, their Bastille Day, and a street's closed, people having picnics, watching the fireworks, and you just run them over. 10 children dead. Now it's 84 dead. Over 50 in critical condition. Hundreds more injured. People had to run, jumping into the ocean to get away. And guess what? Facebook, I'm going to keep saying this over and over again. The video, we played it last hour. We need to have major news reporting on this. Will not let you put in the words Islamic terror. Or terrorist, or Islam. It says Muslims aren't terrorists. You fast forward in the video, it'll show it, a close-up. And then it tells you what to say. Muslims are not terrorists. We try to say terrorist, and it says Muslims are not terrorists. Well, that's quite a spell checker for you with your keywords. So you think with your iPhone, it's cute. Oh, it won't let me say the F word. It says duck. You see where all this is going? And then Zuckerberg comes out and says, oh, he's going to censor, but don't worry, CNN, the New York Times, look at this. Media blames truck, not terrorists or Islam. In fact, I've heard people out there saying, oh, Fort Hood was just mental illness. Oh, San Bernardino was workplace violence. Oh, the guy out in Florida, he wasn't Islamic. No, no, his family, his dad, all just bring in the jihadis and call for it. He's just joining us at the bottom of the hour. I wanted him to pop in. Almost 2 years ago, he wrote the article for his website dealing with Tattoo and the Islamic invasion. We'll put that on screen for TV viewers. You can go to his website and read it. Tet Take 2, Islam's 2016 European Offensive. And again, that's updated from when he wrote in 2014-2015. And his website's enemiesforeignanddomestic.com. He's a best-selling author and a former Navy SEAL. I know he's a very humble guy and says, well, I'm not really a big deal or anything. But the point is, he comes highly recommended from smart folks we talk to that are patriots. They say, well, we can't tell you anything. Just go get Matt Bracken on. He'll tell you what they're really planning. I'm going to say this before we go to Matt. I want to ask him this question. Is there any doubt that this is a coordinated globalist program allied with Islam and Saudi Arabia to bring down the left and to merge with the left, Islam with the left, and to actually persecute everyone that doesn't submit, saying it's our fault the Muslims are attacking? Germany's already doing it. Sweden's already doing it. France is already arresting people. Facebook's already censoring. They're already censoring. Newspaper people are going along with it and will not use the words. I mean, this is crazy that we're under attack and we've got a globalist-run information war where we can't even say who is attacking us. And you've got every weirdo leftist group. They have major Hollywood movies out attacking me by name, saying I'm an Islamophobe and need to be locked up. I mean, the Democratic Party platform says arrest climate change deniers. I mean, is this really their attack plan? Because you predicted it. It's here. The attacks are bigger. They're coming closer together. Matt Bracken.
Hi, Alex. It's a terrible day, but you keep wondering at what point will there be a turning point? Today, I saw President Hollande of France, and his remarks in Nice never mentioned Islam, just terrorism.
He's like the one that brought him in. He's the one that brought him in. Right. He's allied with him. He's their general.
In Germany, they're arresting people that post anything about the invasion on social media. They're not arresting the Islamists. They're arresting the people who warn about the Islamists. And in our country, from our president to our Department of Homeland Security, they're traitors. At this point in 2016, you have to say, if you're still pretending that this is nothing to do with Islam, then you are either secretly already a Muslim or you've already made your separate peace as a dhimmi. That's under the Sharia. People have to understand, when Newt was talking about Sharia, Sharia is not just something for Muslims to abide. When Sharia law comes, everybody has to abide it. Now, if you're a Christian or a Jew, you don't have to become a Muslim. You can become a dhimmi, D-H-I-M-M-I. That's a category, like a caste, meaning you have to be submitted, you have to be humiliated, an official second or third class citizen.
And that's if you're in the few countries where they decide to use you as slaves. In most countries, they go ahead and just run you out or kill you.
Right, or take your women as sex slaves. Now, 2 weeks ago, Jay Johnson was on in a Senate hearing. Ted Cruz and others on the Senate Intelligence Committee. The week earlier, they had Phil Haney and some other patriots on. Phil Haney wrote "See Something, Say Nothing" about how he was kicked out of the Department of Homeland Security.
We've had him on,
and right, and all of the words that describe Islamic terrorism. Islam, jihad, ummah.
They're not allowed to use it in the investigations. What do you make of us now? No one on Facebook can even, in their keyword, add that to their tags.
Yeah, and it's a shame that even the FBI, as we've seen with Comey, taking a dive, obviously the word got to him.
Sure, so let's talk big picture. Big picture, what's the master plan in all this? I mean, what are the socialists, the globalists thinking? Hitting us with probably 1 million refugees here, 5 million in Europe. They're hiding the numbers. We know that. What's the big plan?
the socialists think that they can ride the tiger of Islam, but in the end, they'll convert, because secular atheists never have a problem converting like Carlos the Jackal did to Islam, because to a secular atheist, saying 10 or 12 words about Muhammad and Islam, that's just, you know, an incantation.
And as long as they can kill Christians, I mean, that's the real target. I mean, they want to mount our head on the wall, so they like it.
Well, of course they like it. Now, in the end, the Islamists will win because they're willing to behead everybody in sight, including atheists that don't convert. So the atheists will convert. The left will just, like Carlos the Jackal, the left will just switch gears.
Listen, we go out to rallies and see women saying they're feminists, just worshiping Islam and attacking us that we dare criticize it. And they're like crazy. They go, I love Islam. I'm a feminist. Ah. You're like, that's an oxymoron, lady.
Yeah, they're brainwashed. We make fun of North Koreans running out and, you know, going and swooning over their dear leader. But these women in Europe are just as crazy as the North Koreans. You know, they are practically like the children in the Pied Piper of Hamlet story, where they will willingly drown themselves because it's their brainwashing is that deep. People have to understand.
It's Stockholm syndrome.
And that's why it's so important. Your tagline. There's a war on for your mind. It's absolutely true. And Facebook is the leading fountain of this brainwashing. So resisting Facebook is critical. I was suspended for a couple days from Facebook for just posting a text-only meme, wondering when the moderate Muslims were going to, you know, have a rally against Islamic terrorism. That got me banned for a few days with, you know, threats of being thrown out forever. It's really upside down world. I don't know where we go if Facebook won't let you post the truth.
Well, and people say, well, just leave it. No, it's been given all the attention. It's the platform. It's where the war is. We're going to win, right, and force them to censor us and force them out in the open, like Hillary censoring our aircraft banner hangs. It's only going to make us resist more. Now, Matt Bracken, I want to hold you over when Paul Watson joins us as well. You talked about the frequency increasing when you were here a month ago. You talked about the attacks getting bigger. I've got to believe at some point this backfires, where none of our media will say Islamic terror other than a few people on Fox News. And again, Newt Gingrich is a globalist, but he's telling the truth here. This is a war. We are in a war. And if someone says they want Sharia law, that means they're not going to comply with our law, and they're going to try to force us under it, like the mayor of London is now doing. So let's play this clip of Newt Gingrich.
Western civilization is in a war. We should, frankly, test every person from here who is of a Muslim background, and if they believe in Sharia, they should be deported. Sharia is incompatible with Western civilization. Modern Muslims who have given up Sharia, glad to have them as citizens.
All right, let me stop there. Let me just stop right there.
We need to be fairly...
People call that a radical statement. You can't go to an Islamic country and not submit to them. You go to Saudi Arabia and preach the gospel, you'll be arrested and in prison. So again, they're not tolerant of our tolerance. BS, get the hell out. That's not a radical statement.
We're very fortunate in this country because we do have a constitution. Unlike in Britain, for example, they have no First Amendment or Second. Germany, where they're arresting people for making posts, truthful posts about Islam. But we have a constitution that all the military, police, and government officials have to swear to uphold the Constitution. Part of the Constitution, I forget where it is, what article it is the supreme law of this country. Well, Sharia to a Muslim
article
is the
9.
Supreme law of the world. Right? Sharia law is the law of the world. And if you are a believing Muslim, you believe that no man-made law, which is what they consider the Constitution, no man-made law can be above Sharia law. Now, Sharia law holds that women are worth half of a man. A woman who is raped can be stoned to death for adultery if she doesn't have 4 male witnesses conveniently testifying on her behalf. You know, gays can be thrown off of buildings. This is all Sharia law. Now, I wish that the mainstream media, when they play that clip by Newt, they don't explain what Sharia law is, but at least a lot of the sheeple today, at least they've heard of Sharia law.
Absolutely. Stay there, Matt Bracken. We're going to ask the question, though, what's the end game? What do you see happening next? I've been doing this 21 years. I've been politically involved 25 years. I've studied history. I've interviewed the experts across the board. I've tried to hold all this back. But, I mean, I'm actually getting storable food. I'm actually getting medical supplies. I'm actually getting firearms ready. And I've always had some of that. But, I mean, I'm, like, actually getting the solar panels, you know, on the roof. actually, you know, turned on and working, because I'm a busy guy. I'm actually developing collapse plans now, because I've studied history. I've talked to the experts. I'm looking at what's going on with our power plants getting shut down, the cultural warfare, the attack on the family, the open borders, the government ordering the Border Patrol to release people with TB by the thousands, and it's just spreading everywhere. And I'm like, my God, we are really under attack. This is not negligence. And I know we've had corruption and problems, but I used to get chills every few days thinking about this. I get chills all the time now. My physiology is like, get ready to kick ass. And believe me, I'm not looking for trouble, folks, but you just see the acceleration of everything. The you know, the mass killings, the killing of cops, the leftist operations, all of it. It's like evil is being turned loose. And Matt Bracken's riding shotgun with us into the next segment with Paul Watson, former Navy SEAL, author, researcher, who's really predicted all of this. But I got to tell you, it's not a good move for the Western elite, who had everything sewn up, until you realize they have a desire to bring down the West because they want to control free will. They want a technocracy. And they think their technocracy is going to be able to control Islam, and they're going to double cross it. That is what's happening. Matt Bracken's right. And I am really upset. I mean, I don't care who you are. It's time to get out of your box. It's time to get aggressive. Matt Bracken, what do we do to really get aggressive? I'm trying as hard as I can. Do you concur with me, though, that this confirms our worst analysis? I mean, this is worse than I thought. It seems like they're moving the timetable up.
Yeah, this is a takedown. This is a destabilization. It's going to accelerate. It's going to go algorithmic. We just had a sidebar diversion over to Nice, France, and that's terrible for Europe and terrible for the world. But I have to go back to Dallas. This is a progression. Obama and his gang have been stoking the racial flames. They got the action that they wanted in Dallas. The next step, and what they really need, is for a right winger to do a magazine dump into a BLM mob on a freeway, something like that. I'm very concerned about the convention next week. Obviously, a lot of morons have just figured out that if they rent a truck, they can cause mass casualty mayhem. People that might not have thought about that before, they all know now. And the problem that I see is that at some point, somebody's going to unload a magazine right into a crowd. Now, the guy in Dallas, Micah X. Johnson, he at least was using a scope and aiming at police. Otherwise, there would have been 30 other civilians shot. But the next target, which is just going to be a mob of BLM people, you won't need a scope. All you'll need is a perch on a highway overpass, and you'll just be aiming into a crowd of 1,000 people. So every round is going to hit one or two or three. That's the next step on the progression. That's the next thing that I see coming.
Are you saying BLM is going to hit a general crowd, or the globalists will hit BLM to false flag and make them go crazy?
Either a false flag or an own goal. Or just some, you know, right winger who's off the deep end, who's saying, you know, I'm going to now strike back for.
Sure, because this is mass mind control. When the media promotes BLM and Obama says it's the cops' fault, it's going to make somebody on the other side unstable and go do this. And they just know by the law of numbers.
They can't have any more left wingers. It doesn't help them when a BLM guy like Micah X. Johnson does it. They need some cracker to do it. They need to provoke some cracker into, you know, firing off a couple magazines into a BLM crowd. I see that as the next step. But the big goal is the elections. If Trump is leading or even close, the left is going to pull out all the stuff.
And by the way, he really is now probably leading. He's pulled ahead of Hillary from our internal polling and experts. They now admit that. And that's why they're going into high gear. I agree.
And if there's a security climate that is dangerous enough, there might not be elections in November. If there's a race war going on in October, you know, with any time a group of people crowds together, they get
sure. What is it? And we're going to hold you over. What does it signify then that he met with the leader of BLM 3 days ago for 3 hours? Obama.
Well, it signifies that they're rolling on with the plan. And I don't expect a smooth transfer of power in January. There might not even be elections in November.
Yeah, let's talk about that with yourself, Matt Bracken, and Paul Watson straight ahead. I'm Alex Jones. And folks, we're not playing games. I've got total skin in the game. I'm up in Cleveland on the street for 5 days. Okay, so, I mean, this is the battle for the Republic. And if we let these people intimidate us and stand down, they're going to dig you out of your house later. You got to face them on the field now. Now is the info war. 100% commitment. It's hard to believe the globalists are really doing it. I knew this stuff was on the drawing board. Man, they are crazy. So was Hitler. So was Stalin. I mean, it's just... But I tell you, they always overestimate their power. They always think they're going to break the West will. And in the end, the globalists are going to fall. This is going to be the final fall. May take 20 years, maybe might take a year. But the best laid plans of mice and men often go astray. They're not getting away with this. And I feel sorry for Muslims. They are brainwashed cult members, bullied by their own system, tortured in their own countries. And then so many of them come here and they're henpecked into their orthodoxy. And, you know, and their kid goes out and kills somebody because they're following Islam. So I welcome Islamic heretics that want to be free. The problem is fundamentally the religion says a lot of people say that you're not violent when you are. But never deny the martyrs. So it's all very schizophrenic. That's why they'll never say they're sorry for what these Islamists do. And the controlled corporate weaponized media will never make them say it because they won't tell you it's Islamic. And they'll censor your website. They'll censor your YouTube. The answer is double down. And then when they censor you, double down again and sue them if you have to. I mean, I've sued. I filed lawsuits before for censorship. Let me tell you, it got YouTube's attention. And Hillary's trying to block our aircraft in the skies with Hillary for president. She's not going to stop you getting the T-shirts. She's not going to stop us with trucks now in Cleveland and in Philadelphia. I've doubled and tripled down now. We're about to order in Philadelphia like 50 trucks one day with Hillary for president. I mean, I'm just all in. And we'll putting 50 trucks out there for that day with huge billboards saying Hillary for president. Will that bring her down? No, but that action of resistance, that spirit will, of defiance to tyranny, never submitting, never backing down, never giving in, and fighting hard. Because you think it's a hard battle now. Wait till they get more of their controls in, folks. The number one meme for a week was Hillary for president. It's shaking her up. That's just one thing you did, listeners. And our big secret is we're going to teach other people how to fight back so that it doesn't matter what they do to me. The signal, the way to take them down, the blueprint is already out there. And I studied it from history. I integrated it with modern information and the truth, and it's unstoppable. That's a good feeling. The question is, how bad's this war going to get till the globalists give up? I'll use the World War II analogy like at Stalingrad or Leningrad. When the Germans were already beat and collapsed, Hitler didn't give up. It took him a couple of years till they dug him out of his bunker. We've already, I believe, historically defeated the New World Order with Brexit and the rest of it. They know that now. And they're launching desperate Battle of the Bulge type counteroffensives that are going to fail. But do we want to go through 20 years of fighting the New World Order? Or do we want to have a mass awakening now and start the program of reversing this? Before I go any further, I'm going to go to our guest. Everybody knows what those of us that are on the tip of the spear are up against. I'm no hero. I'm not going to sit here and have these people overrun us, have the globalists brainwash us, have them destroy our families, shut our country and nations down. I mean, this is like watching my neighbor's house burn or my own house burn. If I get out of the bed and try to get out of the house, I'm not a hero. It's self-preservation. That's what I'm saying. You couldn't get me to stop doing this. You put a gun to my head, I'm not going to stop. I mean, it's just I'm fully, absolutely committed because I'm alive. The general public's in a trance. It's time to break it. They need to see Hillary for president shirts everywhere. You need to get them at InfoWarsStore.com. People need to see our films, our books, our information, Molon Labe everywhere. You need to buy the nutraceuticals so you can be healthier and more focused, like DNA Force, 25% off. We hardly ever do that. It will sell out by next week. We need you to get the X2. We need you to get the non-GMO heirloom seeds and the brain force and then the super high-quality storable foods. And we have the best solar panel systems, you name it. And the vitamin mineral fusion, fruit punch, all of it's the very best vitamins, the very best supplements. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com. Or call toll-free 888-253-3139. They wouldn't be censoring InfoWars. They wouldn't be censoring the word Islamic terror. They wouldn't be doing all this if we didn't have a capability to bring them down because you are the power. I'm going to Paul Watson, then back to Bracken here in a moment. Former Minnesota Governor Jesse Ventura is going to be joining us. We'll see where his take is on all this. But before we go any further, again, Hillary hates Hillary for prison shirts. That's why everybody should get them. It's that simple. If they were invincible, she wouldn't be trying to threaten comedy clubs and not make fun of her. They wouldn't be trying to, you know, threaten aircraft companies that already said, we can't fly your planes, you know, they'll come after us. And then now we find a company that'll do it, and then they do a first-time exclusion zone for 30 miles out at the RNC and DNC. It's because it is effective they're putting up defenses. It's because they do know, they are aware. We've identified them. The globalists are now out in the open. This is the beginning of the end, so they're going to launch everything they've got at us. We'll talk to Matt Bracken about that of enemiesforeignanddomestic.com here in just a moment. Former Navy SEAL, best-selling author, really smart guy that's predicted all of this with his Tattoo Islamic Invasion articles. Let's go to Paul Watson to get his take from London, England. He's got family right outside Nice, so this is personal for him. DrudgeReport.com is now linked to our article. Thank God. Media blames truck, not terrorist or Islam, for Nice attack. It's part of the censorship, part of the war on the American people, the part of the war on truth. I mean, this is coordinated. This is military-level brainwashing. This is war-level disinfo. Facebook will not let us put in the words Islamic terror on our own videos. I mean, this, we have it on video and tells us Islam is not, Muslims are not terrorists. That's what we're allowed to say. I mean, this is so unprecedented to see coordination with the big tech companies, Western governments. Facebook, for years, calls the German police when someone says, we're under an invasion, and they come and arrest you. I mean, I know we keep saying that. This is, Facebook wants to do that here. Zuckerberg wants you arrested. He's an enemy of this country. He's part of a takeover. This is 21st century war, folks. It isn't the Japanese bombing Pearl Harbor now. This is global government with Soros and these other people coming after us with an army of jihadis. I talked to Paul last night, even before Newt Gingrich had said this before. And I said, what is this, Paul? And he said, this is war. War on the West, attempted takedown. He goes, we're taking the gloves off. And I said, that's right. I want the gloves off and I want brass knuckles on. We are going all out. Paul Watson, give us your take on the situation. The 84 dead, over 100 wounded, 50 plus in critical condition. Hollande, who lowered the drawbridge, called the enemy in with the signals, is now presiding over another death banquet. What a horrible demonic creature.
Well, I mean, it is a war, Alex, but the problem is many of our leaders have already completely capitulated. And you can see that today from the reaction from Manuel Valls. This is the French prime minister who said that France learned to, quote, live with terrorism. He actually said the French people must now tolerate the mangled, limbless corpses of innocent people, of innocent children on the streets, because that's the new reality. They've got to get used to it. And that's why France being attacked over and over again, because they've surrendered. Because that's where they're going to institute the first area.
Even when you surrender, they other groups don't do this. When you surrender to Islam, it gang rapes you even harder.
Yeah. And then look at these headlines. Ignore the hysteria. Europe can live with terror. Another one out of the game. Sympathy should be our only response to the Nice terror attack. This is how the terrorists are winning. This emboldens. This is why they keep attacking France, because now they think we've got our foot in the door. This is really working.
Sure. They're trying to break our will, Paul. The media is trying to normalize this. They're running up the white flag. That's the headline. Western media runs up white flag. Please continue.
Look at this. Hours before the Nice attack. Literally 2 hours before. In fact, 2 hours before. President Hollande. Quote, what threatens us is the rise of populism. That's a quote 2 hours before this attack. The rise of populism. These people are more afraid of losing political power, of so-called right-wing populist parties getting in power, than the fact that their country, almost every month now, is being bombarded again and again. They're more afraid of being called Islamophobic. And this, the same goes for the left, than people with whom they disagree getting a chance at power. And, you know, I talked about this in a video, which has just gone up on InfoWars about 30 minutes ago. You know, the left, you've capitulated, you've lost, you have no argument remaining. Now it's somebody else's turn to actually try and fix this massive mess that you've created.
But they know that. They want to burn everything down because they can't compete with real liberalism and the Renaissance. The body snatcher always wants to kill what it's copying. Paul, I think you underestimate their evil.
No, I totally agree. I'm just talking to the few leftists who are still ignorant and
Well, they don't matter. I mean, they all are triggly puffs and can't even talk. But sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, they have allied themselves with the Islamists because, again, they share the same goals. In this video, again, I post the screenshot out of ISIS's own manifesto where they say, we're going to go and recruit the left wing, the, quote, anti-Zionist, the pro-Palestinian people. We're going to radicalize them. We're going to arm them because they roughly share the same beliefs. They hate the West. They want to bring it down. People always say, why don't the left ever criticize Islam? Many of them are aligned with Islam. They've allied with Islamists. That's the danger here. It's not just individual attacks. It's the complete subversion of our society from a fifth column that's helping them do this.
Sure. And why do the jihadists always attack those that submit? I mean, their own hell pit countries. I mean, I guess it's like 1984. It's a boot stomping on the face forever. They just all persecute their daughters, their husbands. It's a constant torture, murder, execution, death, lying, weird old men stomping around like, blah, 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 blah. I mean, it's like, what the hell is going on here?
And then look at this comment again from the Prime Minister Valls, who basically surrendered today and said, you just got to get used to dead little children on the streets. It's just the new norm. He said that this is before the attack. He said, quote, no legal basis for arresting the European jihadists or barring them from leaving or entering France. He went on to say, quote,
excuse me, he said, let jihadists in. Yeah.
He went on to say, quote, the fighters in Syria are not fighting against the Assad regime. So they openly admitted that they were letting these people in and out of France because they were fighting Assad, who's actually destroying ISIS and Al-Qaeda. He said that before the attack. These people are fifth columnists. These people are even more dangerous than ISIS because they hold the reins of power. And again, absolutely shocking comment.
Well, Paul, I'm completely blown away. Stay there. I want to get Matt Bracken, again, former Navy SEAL, author, anti-terrorism researcher who predicted this Islamic tattoo would be kicking off big time this year. More and more frequent, larger attacks in concert, like a major war. Just like the globalists launched Arab Spring with his jihadists to take over the Middle East. Matt, this is clearly coordinated with high-level, state-level, international-level coordination with the media to cover this up and carry this out. This is amazing. What do you expect to happen next?
First, I want to say, Paul Joseph Watson, your videos are amazing. My daughter and her generation are turned on to them. I can't say enough about your videos. I think they're at the very top of the entire genre. Now, something that I need to use two Arabic words. One is jizya and one is dhimmi. Another concept in English is called the bride price. When a trader comes over, say back in the Cold War era terms, a Russian trader came over, the bride price were the secrets that he brought. You know, you didn't just show up and say, I hate the KGB. You had to burn some KGB people back in Moscow. That's the bride price. The Hollande and Merkel, their jizya, their bride price for continuing in power under the new caliphate is to betray their own people, to lie to their about their own people and to their own people.
Right. So they've, in fact, they've had the meetings where they say, you've got to give us cover for our jihad. We want to see you let us do this. Just like a gang member to be initiated has got to go kill an old lady for no reason. This is literally a gang initiation.
Well, this is a gang initiation where the leaders of Europe are lying to their own people, and they know they're lying to their own people. This is their bride price, their jizya tax for becoming safe dhimmis and keeping their power. Now, some of them might just out and out say, I converted long ago, I'm a Muslim, fooled you. Or they might say, as long as I keep my palace and my villa and my estate, I don't really care. But their bride price, their jizya tax, is to sell out their own people. People need to understand this. Our leaders, like Jay Johnson at this Senate Intelligence Committee 2 weeks ago, he was asked about Phil Haney and the say something, say nothing. He said he had no idea. Ted Cruz had a big chart behind him with all of the words in the 9/11 report that had been expunged year by year. And Jay Johnson just flicked his hand and said, I have no idea what you're talking about. So these guys,
it's the same way they denied world government as they built it. Now it's out in the open. They deny the Islamic invasion. This is the mind control and call you a conspiracy theorist. They're actually now saying that if you say this was Islamic. But there's new headlines. We are conspiracy theorists.
We need to see them and call them traitors.
I agree with you. Now, let's expand on this. Let's expand on this, Matt Bracken, because what you said is absolutely at the heart of this. You look at the London mayor, all of this. Once they get in, they activate and let you know, yes, we're conquering you. Yes, we're taking you over. Because whatever you want to say about Islam, it at least wants to take over, is dominant, will do whatever, and has a long-term strategic plan. The globalist minions just want to sell out and are such total scum. How do we counter that?
A bad ideology beats no ideology. Even an evil, bad cult beats secular nothingness and nihilism.
That's right.
You know, the postmodern nihilistic, all things are the same. There's no good. There's no bad. That means Islam wins. Because
don't we need a new crusade? I mean, the crusade's got a dirty name, but we were attacked for 400 years before we went in there and kicked their ass. And I'm sorry, if they want one, and this time we won't attack countries that are moderate. Saudi Arabia and all these other jihad centers, they want to fight. They need to really get one.
Well, the good thing is that we have this constitution, so we have at least a legal trench line to fight in, which is that our constitution is above Sharia law. And anybody who says, for example, Hillary Clinton, she wants to pass this thing called UN Resolution 1618, which outlaws blasphemy against Islam. Like Obama said, you know, the future must not belong to those who slander the prophet.
And that's why the internet now won't let you criticize Islam enemy, because that's blasphemy. Gone is our First Amendment.
Well, that's Sharia. That's submission to Sharia. But there are thousands of veterans, particularly those who have fought in the Middle East, that have seen this evil up close, and they're locked and loaded, and they are not going to submit. I guarantee you they're not.
I was about to say, I don't know what the globals think they bit off, but they are. This is like two freight trains at 100 miles an hour going towards each other. It is crazy. It is crazy. And it is just unbelievable to see this happening. Matt Bracken's our guest. So is Paul Watson. I'm Alex Jones, Infowars.com. Stay with us on the other side of this break. A lot of key intel. Islam gives them 1,400,000,000 or so people that are used to living under tyranny and who are willing to go out and kill innocent people whenever they're told to. But to stir up these people, the West has also launched wars over there that actually targeted the enemies of radical Islam, which shows you this has been a long-term strategic plan. But this isn't the 1990s where they could just deny there was a treaty or deny there was an open border. We're exposing it. Infowars.com has been on the front lines of that. Whether it's Obama opening the borders and trying to cover it up or the Islamists being brought in, I think time is on our side overall. I wanted to ask Paul Watson his view on this and other tidbits, but I just don't see how, as this intensifies, they're going to be able to cover up that there's Islamic terror and that it's increasing. And I just can't believe that the president and others of France are just making jokes about this and saying we've got to just get used to it. And, you know, we've got to just let jihadis come and go. I mean, he's like kissing their butts, I guess, so he hopes they don't come kill him. I mean, is it just the incredible cowardice of these people, or what is it, Paul?
I mean, you could say it was Stockholm syndrome, but they've completely capitulated. The narrative that you're now getting, and you get this after every single attack, is, you know, oh, this is just going to make the right wing get into power. This is going to cause more division if the right wing sees power, and then there'll be more attacks. So again, it's that same narrative. We're not being nice enough to the precious Islamists. You know, don't upset them. We have to appease them, otherwise they'll kill us. Don't insult them. Don't draw the Prophet Muhammad. Well, it hasn't worked, has it? It hasn't worked. They've completely failed. Multiculturalism has failed. Most of these jihadists come from these Islamic ghettos created by the left's mass immigration policy.
Well, they all get free welfare, free everything, and they just sit around in these diaper outfits bitching all day. It's like in Germany, we interview them. They're like, I got here. Everything's free. I'm going to take over. I hate Germany, and I hate Germans. And they're just so honest, like, I hate you. And the guy's just like a cartoon character.
But also, you know, it's not just socioeconomics. A lot of the suicide bombers are actually well-educated. So you can't just blame that as well.
Sure, so what comes next? I mean, where does this all end, Paul?
Well, we're in a war. I mean, the head of the French police last week said one or two more Islamic terror attacks in France, it's civil war. Now, the French have largely capitulated. What I'm predicting is this is going to happen in Germany. There's going to be a massive attack, and there's going to be a massive backlash. There's going to be civil unrest. There's going to be riots on the streets. It's only a matter of time.
And let's be clear about the French head cop, though. He was saying, I'm worried about right-wingers. We've got to pounce on them. So they're gonna go raid the right-wingers if they even speak out.
No, exactly. And then you were talking about see something, say nothing. They let this guy sit on the road in his truck for 9 hours when this road was supposed to be blocked off to all traffic. They questioned him. They did nothing. We saw with San Bernardino, the neighbors, they saw the packages coming in, said nothing for fear of being called racist.
They always nest in leftist areas. That's a great point. I'm going to hold you guys over 5 minutes. Ventura's coming up. I want to get final comments from both. Matt Brackett, it seems they always attack in nesting areas of ultra-left, and they go kill their leftist friends. Is this part of the loving Islam?
Well, Islam is indiscriminate in terms of who they murder. They just, you saw in Baghdad, that was just Sunni versus Shia bringing a truck bomb into their holiest hour of the end of Ramadan party, sort of like Bastille Day for Islam. That's when they detonated this huge truck bomb in the middle of a affluent Shia shopping center. I want to mention before I go, since the last time I was on, I wrote a short story called Piss Christ, Piss Koran, ! That's on gatesofvienna.net. There are ways to fight back. There are some people that will fight back. We won't submit. Now, my biggest fear is that at the end of the day, the grid goes down. Almost every scenario results in a possible grid collapse.
Hold on, we're back in 70 seconds. I want you to spend a few minutes on that, because it's not just the Islamists they're bringing in. Again, the people running our country are trying to collapse us while building breakaway government reservations and corporate systems that are exempt to bring in a kind of new dark age where they then reorganize things. Stay with us. Matt Bracken's our guest. We're getting into the incremental selective enforcement of industrial society, the post-industrial world that the United Nations officially has as international law. But again, the future will not be evenly distributed, and is not distributed evenly. It's being distributed to the globalists that siphon off our energy, our industry, our inventions, build their globalist system while collapsing the world into quagmire, using Islam and socialist revolutions to dumb the public down and put them into two different forms of brainwashing control. Mr. Bracken, finish up with a few minutes on that, and we'll talk to Paul Watson. But you were talking about their plan as they attack our energy supplies, our grids, everything.
Well, going back to the beginning of the show, you said you're not a hero or not a brave man. I think you are. I think that all of us now, we need to stand on the skyline. You know, our training is to hide in the ditches, to take a good shot and not to ever skyline ourselves. But those of us in what you might call leadership positions, it is our duty to skyline ourselves, which you are certainly doing going to Cleveland. And I admire you greatly for that. Also, Paul Watson, tremendous videos. If we're all the gray man, then 1984 wins. So there is a time to hide. Now is not the time. Now is the time to stand tall. I do fear that there's not going to possibly not be an election. Certainly there won't be a smooth transfer of power. I expect assassinations. I expect, you know, Nice-style attacks. I expect magazine dumps into crowds coming up, because Team Tyranny is going to pull out all the stops. We're going to see an escalation that's going to make our heads spin. And we have to be prepared for that. This is all part of a destabilization.
Isn't the good news, though, that I see the military is almost completely awake? Cops are really waking up. I mean, are you seeing that?
Yes, but the problem is, if the power goes out, it's very hard for us to organize. You know, forget about Facebook. There won't be television. So we have to be prepared for a lot of worst-case scenarios, like my short story, What I Saw at the Coup, my other short story, Alas, Brave New Babylon.
Sure. Well, I just want to be clear on the whole angle. I know there's no future if we don't fight now. And we that's why I am willing to take basically any risk at this point. And I feel good about it, because I realize down the road it gets too horrible. Matt Bracken.
We're not youngsters. You know what? We've had a great life. We've had a great shot. We owe it to the next generation. Maybe they're being raised as brainwashed.
That's right. There had to be some men in this age to stand up. We'll talk to you again coming up maybe this Sunday, because I'm going to be flying to Cleveland there. But We're going to have David Knight here, so hopefully you'll pop in with us for an hour. We'll talk to you again, Mr. Bracken. God bless you.
Thank you.
Absolutely. I mean, there are still men left in the world. I'll just say that. And I'm not bowing down to any of this crap. I'm done. Thank you, sir. Paul Watson, you got a minute and a half. Thank you for joining us. The great work you're doing.
Paul? Yeah, I just finished by saying, you know, this is the most tumultuous year politically in my entire life. There's going to be more terror attacks. There's going to be riots. There's going to be civil unrest across the West. But this will lead to the rise of populism, as it's already doing throughout Europe and also in America. And that's the necessary medicine we need. The left's policy of multiculturalism has completely failed. Their neoliberal military interventionism has completely failed. It's blown back. It's created an absolute disaster. And we need actual leaders to step up and fix this complete mess. And hopefully that's what's going to happen.
What else are you looking at, Paul? What else is going up on Infowars.com? I'm very thankful that Drudge is pointing out that the newspapers won't say Islamic terror and say truck. But this Facebook, for me, not letting us put in Islamic terror, I mean, in live time, that should be the top story in the country. There's proof to the Senate of incredible censorship.
Oh, no, they're banning people all over Facebook. I've got to put one up on Twitter. It's a quote. Somebody posted on Facebook, "I'm going to condemn Muslims and their death cult religion. I'm not going to say pray for France." Banned, deleted, within hours of this attack. So that's the most important thing, is banning, deleting.
And they target the little people first. They don't try to ban the big guys first. They ban the little people thinking you have no voice. That's why you fight harder, because you really are who are important. Well, for this hour, former Minnesota governor, best-selling author, former Navy SEAL, movie star, patriot, TV show host, Jesse Ventura is our guest. I remember when he, for several years, was kicked off of MSNBC back when it had bigger ratings than CNN or Fox, you know, huge ratings. They killed it. He wouldn't endorse the Iraq war, so they just kicked him off the air, even though he had great ratings. That's why I really respect Jesse Ventura. You also have somebody like Donald Trump, who was against the war at that time. And so even though I don't agree with maybe 10% of what Jesse Ventura stands for, it doesn't matter, because all I want is somebody that has integrity, whether they be a talk show host or whether they be a president or a governor. And that's what it's really all about. What Jesse Ventura says he stands for is what he stands for. And there's so much to talk to him about, but I got to tell you, getting to know him now, hard to believe, like 8-9 years ago. And now, being a guest on several seasons of his popular show, Conspiracy Theory. Everything we talked about, the NSA spying, the FEMA centers, that's now been declassified, by the way, last year. We've covered the resettlement program, the program for world government, atmospheric manipulation, that's been partially declassified. The Brexit, you know, leaving the euro, all of this is what he and I and others have covered, because it was in the documents. It wasn't speculation. It really is mind-blowing. And so we have to ask ourselves, what point have we gotten to as a civilization where world government is out in the open? They admit it's a corporate, unelected world government. And those of us that exposed it before it was even admitted to exist, do we get an apology? And see, it's not about those of you that exposed us getting an apology or myself getting an apology. It's about the fact that we knew what was going on. We understood what was unfolding. We warned people accurately. And so the general public needs to remember that, and they are starting to remember that. And so, yes, this show and others like it have more credibility, and you've got all the government disinfo shills out there that cause infighting and, you know, make up silly stories and things that can't be proven. But to be called a conspiracy theorist is just someone that is questioning known liars in the political spectrum and all these multinational interests that are coming in and taking control of our government and our process. And I think we can all agree, no matter what color we are or what party we're in or where we're from, that we just want transparency. We want our governments back. We want to be populist. Now, the question is, what type of populist are you? We're going to Jesse Ventura's phone drop. He just came back. We know that we've attacked the Middle East for no reason. We know we've overthrown moderates. We know now they've put in radicals and then have opened up Europe and the West to it to cause a destabilization that I believe will be a backlash to further invade the Middle East in the future, but also take our liberties domestically. Full spectrum dominance. And I want to get Jesse Ventura's take on that. I want to talk about his new book, one of many bestsellers. Bleep politicians talk about. S-word politicians say. Stuff politicians say. The funniest, dumbest, most outrageous things ever uttered by leaders. Number one, I haven't read the book yet, but it's got to be where the congressman thinks that Guam is a floating island. You're a former Navy SEAL, Governor. Let's fact check that congressman from Georgia. Do islands float, sir? What are islands?
Do islands float? I don't think so. I've been all through Southeast Asia and great parts of the Pacific. I did 17 months deployed overseas, two tours, and I never ran into any floating islands.
Well, you're a conspiracy theorist for saying.
And I had to swim in a lot of those waters, so I would have been up close and personal to them too.
Well, we're not going to believe you. We're just going to say you're a conspiracy theorist because the congressman said they float. Wow, where should we start? I mean, what do you think about the terror attacks that we just saw in the last few months, the one last night in Europe?
Well, Alex, what people failed to realize, I was talking somewhere one time, and there was a Muslim girl waited, young, and she had the whole get-up on, you know, the stuff they wear. And, you know, I'm not really privy to it, being a non-believer. I don't pay attention to all that stuff with any of them. But she waited for me, and afterwards she came up to me and said, Governor Ventura, you know exactly, you understand the Middle East. And this is what I had said. All of this stems from the root problem of colonialism that took place decades and decades ago, where Europe, through colonizing the world, at some point did it to the Middle East. And what they did, they formed countries not based upon the tribes there. They based them upon what they wanted. You know, okay, France, you're going to take care of this, and you're going to take care of that, and that, all to profit them.
That's right.
And so you have all the countries have three different religious factions that have been warring for years, and the only way to keep them under control was to have dictators. Well, now we've gone in and taken out all the dictators, and now look what you've got. This is all blowback. This, to me, it's blowback from colonialism.
You're absolutely right, and nobody's talking about that. I mean, you just said that. It's so true. The British created Saudi Arabia out of like four or five groups. Iraq was created out of three different groups. All these countries.
It wasn't done according to the needs of the people there. It was done according to whatever the Europe colonialization wanted. And now it's blowing back on Europe because they're getting hit pretty hard with it. And to me, that's the root problem. Just like, okay, we'll transition to what's happening in America right here with our police and our black community and all this. Okay, racism is definitely one of the problems, but that takes generations to get rid of. You can't change that overnight, people's feelings like that. But here's the root problem, Alex, the war on drugs.
Sure.
That's what's militarized our police. It's made it to where they bust door downs, come in shooting first and asking questions.
Well, I was about
later.
To say, I mean, you can really blame the feds. They have done all the federal training, the instinctive shooting, the no-knock warrants, the asset forfeiture. That is all the federal government, bipartisan, going right back to Richard Nixon. And I say, stop it. Like, just like you say, I totally agree.
Yeah, well, the point is, that's if you end the war on drugs, you end the militarization of our police. When I was doing my internet show, I had a 10 or 12 year Baltimore police cop veteran on, and he agreed with me and concurred fully with that position.
By the way, speaking of that, you've done all sorts of TV shows. Can I talk about the RT thing coming up?
Well, I haven't officially inked it yet. It's unofficial.
I saw it in the news article, so I knew I wasn't leaking something, but I mean, I'd love to see that. Larry King can say whatever he wants on there, so.
Yeah, no, let's just put it this way. I'm in final negotiations with RT.
Good.
And here's what I find amazing is that I grew up, Alex, and lived through the entire Cold War, right? And now I'm censored throughout the United States. I can't get on TV shows. I can't do this. I got 33 media conglomerates opposing my lawsuit to clear my name and all this stuff. And yet, who's going to give me the freedom to speak freely? The Russians?
That's crazy. And you know what's crazy? Because I've talked to folks that have had shows, and I've talked to one of the producers for Larry King, because I've met King before out in L.A., and they said, no, he can just say whatever he wants. They don't even ask what he's going to say. And it's like, wow, you know, working at MSNBC, I know, being around Fox and CNN, they try to control everything you say.
Alex, I found this out when I went to Moscow in December, when Vladimir Putin spoke that night at the 10-year anniversary. He stated he will never interfere artistically. He will never interfere with anything we want to talk
about. But we hear from our media, he totally controls the media.
It's the opposite. I'm going there for freedom. I can't even talk here. It's the Russians who are giving me free speech to Jesse Ventura.
Well, that's because they've already been to the bottom, and we haven't hit the bottom yet, and I don't wonder how far.
Well, the point is, they're embracing capitalism. When I was over there, they're embracing it so much, Alex, all stores are open 24/7.
I know.
That's competition. Everything's open all the time.
Amazing, amazing. Well, I can't wait. I saw
that. Alex, is that not embracing capitalism?
I know. They have lower taxes than we do.
You can go out at 3 in the morning and buy a tuxedo. Someone will be there to wait on you.
That's crazy. Now, I've talked to folks. They're really trying to rebuild Russia. And look at how the West has got all these sanctions and moving weapons in. Did you see Putin come out and warn the press of nuclear war? And the Chinese president just Monday warned of war with the United States. And again, I don't defend the communist Chinese. They're a terrible government, but their people are good. But it's true that the West is really moving in up against their borders.
It's also a fact. I heard Putin speak. He was getting grilled by a BBC guy. And the guy was grilling Putin on Russia's aggression. And Putin was so cool and calm. He said, well, let's put this into common sense for a moment, if we can. Russia has two bases, military, outside of Russia.
Two or three, yeah.
The United States has 178?
Big ones. It's like 500.
Something like that.
About 500.
And like Putin said, using common sense, who's the aggressor? I mean, come on. We got military. I'm for closing them bases and bringing our young men and women home where they belong. And then if you want to have them guard our border, let's do it with the U.S. military.
Well, that's what they're supposed to do in the Constitution.
You know, well, that's what I'm advocating. If you're worried about our borders, let's have the military truly protect America.
Yeah, walls are not going to do it. I mean, I like Trump, but the wall thing, just build a bigger ladder or dig under it. I mean, give me a break. Jesse Ventura is our guest. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Well, talking to my good friend Jesse Ventura during the break, and I say good friend because he just is a really good guy. He's been through so much demonization, so much disinfo. They were scared of him running for president. Well, he was just telling me, you know, he never really made an announcement, but he's not running for president. He was telling me why, and I want him to spend some time talking about that, the state of the world, and where he sees things are going. So, Governor, if you don't mind, repeat what you were just telling me during the break.
Well, I took hard consideration to run, Alex. The libertarians contacted me on two occasions and invited me to their big convention in Orlando. But I chose not to go because I sat down with my wife and we talked. And here's how I felt. I'm 65. I just it's my birthday. I go on Medicare today. Ain't that wonderful?
Happy birthday. I didn't know it was your birthday.
You're welcome. Thank you, I should say. Yeah, anyway, though. Okay, I run and I run to win. And I truly think I could have won in light of the fact that both these candidates have negatives that are, you know, over 50%. But that aside, I had it in my gut to run. I wanted to debate him. I'd love to take him on. But where I fell short in my heart was I didn't feel at this time in my life that I wanted to give 100% till age 70 minimum. And you got to do it. And I just didn't feel I could do that. I if it was 10 years ago, I would have did it. But at this point, personally, in my life, I know I got only a finite number of years left. And as you get older and go on Medicare, it actually becomes more apparent to you, believe it or not. And I just couldn't bring myself to dedicate the 100% needed to do that. And my wife did not want me to run. And she's been with me 41 years. And I always say this, I will pick her over any elected official position.
Well, she's a great lady.
Any of them.
Absolutely. But expanding on why you're very close to doing this big show with RT, RT globally is much bigger than CNN. Hundreds of millions of viewers. I mean, it's really amazing.
It's second only to the BBC now in the world. It's like in 800 million homes throughout the world.
Which shows how discredited our media is. CNN used to be one of the biggest. Now no one will carry it overseas. We're so distrusted. So let's talk about that. You were saying you have a larger mission than just trying to be U.S. president.
Well, when I chose not to run for president, this December, I made a trip to Moscow on behalf of RT, because RT and I are going to work together, Russian television, I hope. We're very close right now to doing the deal. And I'm getting older, and, you know, you choose the things you want to do or the legacy you want to finish your life with. And I was so impressed with the Russian people when I went over there meeting the common people. And it bothered me so much having parents who fought side by side with the Russians as allies in World War II. My father spoke very highly of the Russians he met and knew. And I want my legacy now to be, I want to work for Russian television, and I want to try to bridge the gap any small way I can to make the United States and Russia friends instead of enemies. We should be friends, not adversaries or enemies anymore. They've embraced capitalism so much over there, Alex. Stores, everything is open 24/7. Now that's capitalism.
What do you make of NATO, the globalists, the Republicans and Democrats, Obama, trying to start a war with Russia? It's just crazy. This isn't Iraq.
It is utterly crazy. I met Russian people over there the short time I was there. They're happy people. They're out from underneath communism. They're enjoying a freedom they've never felt before. But they're new. They're just growing at it. Imagine what our country was like in its first 10 years, or whatever it's been now. I guess 91 when it fell, so it's a little over 25 lousy years. Well, they have to have a chance, and we're not giving it to them. Where we ought to be standing with them and working with them, I guess our industrial war machine needs to be fed continually, doesn't it? Well, my job, I believe, in life right now is going to be to try to overbridge that. I want to be friends with Russia, not enemies with
Russia. Sure. Well, world government wants world government, and Russia doesn't want to be part of the world government. So that's what's happened. In fact, it's only Russia that's the holdout. The communist Chinese are heavily involved in the whole project, though they've been kind of double-crossing each other. We're going to break here in a moment and talk about your book. But what do you make of, just briefly, all the communist Chinese talk of war with the U.S.? Just crazy.
Well, I haven't followed that, Alex. That's new to me. I don't watch the news and like you do. You know, I try to break away from it.
Well, our news won't tell anybody about it. We write articles about the official Communist Party saying they're getting ready for war with the U.S. This is unprecedented talk.
Well, you know, I don't know. All I can say is this. I know 2 years ago, there was an international poll done by Gallup, I think, where they polled like 3,000 people internationally. And they posed the question, if you went to war, who do you think would likely be your adversary? 23% of them said the United States.
Let's talk about that. That's a great point. We'll be back. I'll tell you, I've been to a lot of big rallies. I've snuck into Bohemian Grove. I've covered military drills. I've gone out and protested the Ku Klux Klan and Mecha La Raza and the new Black Panther Party. But I do have a few butterflies about what's coming up next week in Cleveland. I'll be there. I'm going to be speaking at some rallies. I'm going to be doing live broadcasts and a lot of big interviews. I'll be wearing my Hillary for Prison shirt. The FBI is saying they think there may be terror attacks at this event or whatever. I think overall it's more dangerous driving down the highway. But what I know is more dangerous is not being engaged, not being involved, and just rolling over. Former Minnesota Governor Jesse Ventura is our guest. SH, you know what T, politicians say. The funniest, dumbest, most outrageous things ever uttered by our leaders. I want to talk some about the book here in a moment. And I want to talk about Ventura's suit he won for defamation. Now that's been overturned, going back to the full court. He's not really been saying a lot about that because obviously it's going to be litigated. But first, let's talk about election 2016. I have problems with Trump saying torture ISIS. Though I don't like ISIS, we know where torture goes. I'd like to have you speak to that. But overall, he's more of a populist. I know you're friends with him. I think he really does want to do some things that will make this country more successful. Hillary is a globalist. She's dialed into all the corruption. Trump is more of an outsider than her. I'm all in for Trump personally. What is your view on 2016 and where this is going? And what is your prediction, Jesse Ventura?
Well, for me, what I want to see happen is this. You got two candidates here, Trump and Hillary, whose negatives are the highest in history. Their negatives are higher than their positives. Their negatives are up 60-some percent and all that. I think it opens the door, finally. Let's have debates and let's include Gary Johnson of the Libertarian Party and give people an alternative to where they can say no to these two parties and yes to a third alternative, finally, in this country. I'm hoping this happens, Alex. I'm hoping Gary Johnson does well enough that he wins his home state, maybe squeaks out somewhere else, and then Trump and Hillary both split the Electoral College so that nobody gets elected. And then maybe out of the 2016 election, they'll do away with the antiquated Electoral College system and go back to a one that says if you get the most votes, you win.
Well, that's a great point, because I understand states that have a lower population not wanting to be slaves of a bigger state. And I get the two senators being sent, but then the House being apportioned. But what I don't like is the 1972-78 rules where the Dems and the Repubs can sit there, the Crips and the Bloods, as you call them, can sit there and say, oh, we don't care about your popular vote. We're just going to give this to whoever we want, like George Will wrote, the sovereigns of the party. Well, the Republicans so far have failed. I talked to Roger Stone today. He was being summoned by Trump, so he couldn't come on today. But he's going to be on this, obviously, in studio coming up at the RNC. But they tried to steal it from Trump. They succeeded with Sanders. And I just can't believe even CNN admitted, well, the AP is overseeing the election, and they met with the superdelegates who said they were going for Hillary. So they agreed to call it for Hillary and not look at the votes in California. That was so surreal for me to see them openly say the popular vote didn't count.
Well, let's just go back to every other election. If you go for mayor, governor, congressman, senator, he who gets the most votes wins. Yet in 2000, Al Gore got 500,000 more votes, yet George Bush was the president. Now, that's insane. How can you get the most votes and lose? It's insane. And the reason you got the Electoral College initially was because they had to do it. They had to ride by horseback to Washington to elect the president, so they had to send delegates. Well, when's the last time anybody went on horseback to Washington?
What do you think of the arrogance of the Dems and Republicans claiming they could just ignore the popular vote openly? I mean, this has been pushed out in the open, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, it's horrible. And the point is, why isn't Gary Johnson? We haven't seen a third party since Ross Perot in 92 up on that stage. Why? What's wrong with having a third or a fourth? Have four people up there, and then people can look at all four of them, or three. Greenie, you can put up there, too. The Green Party, the Libertarians, the Democrats, and the Republicans. And that way the people can hear four people and what their vision is. Because I am voting for Gary Johnson proudly. I'm voting for someone, not against someone.
You have been friends with Trump for a long time. Overall,
yeah, but Gary goes where I go. Gary believes.
Sure. No, I totally respect what you're saying.
And he believes in ending the war on drugs.
Listen, Jesse, I totally hear what you're saying. My question is, separately, just Trump is the man who I know you've been friends with for a long time. Do you think he's for real in what he's doing?
I certainly want to believe he is. I mean, it's the most important job pretty much on the planet.
Well, I think he's very serious. I think he's very serious.
I didn't do it because I didn't feel I could give 100% in doing the job.
What do you make of his overall courage? I mean, out there in the face of all these threats and what he's doing, he's sure working his butt off.
Well, and he needs to, but they should all, he should also be careful. It's a thing, you know, I'm the conspiracy theorist, right? I'm labeled that because I did the TV show and this and that. Well, let's do a scenario for a minute and have a little morbid fun with it, Alex. Okay, you guys, Trump is being set up perfectly to be taken out because he now is going to pick this insider from Indiana who's well-received by the establishment Republicans, quote, to unite the party back. Well, he's only going to be a heartbeat away. Now, who do you think would make the best Lee Harvey Oswald? An undocumented Mexican or a Muslim?
It'd be a disgruntled right-winger. That's what they want to do.
Well, no. I think you put it on to maybe an undocumented Mexican. That way we'll hate Mexico even worse because they, you know, he assassinated Donald. Think what? About it. I mean, I'm having fun if I was a script writer.
No, I hear you. Secret Service admits that Donald Trump is probably the most threatened candidate in history. And we've seen a repeat. And I've talked to the insiders. I'm just going to leave it at that, not just Stone. And what's happened here is, just like 1980 when they told Reagan, you better take George Herbert Walker Bush or we're not going to let you have it. They still are fighting today in the Rules Committee as we speak to try to steal the nomination from Trump. But it's basically failed. And that is from Stone and one other person. But they were just saying Gingrich is even worse. And that's who the elite upped the number. Adelson upped the number to $300 million if Trump would have taken Gingrich. Instead, he took this gentleman, Mr. Pence, Governor Pence, because he's seen as not as aggressive and as dangerous, and they don't see him as somebody that would try to assassinate Trump. Little Bird told me that. So what do you make of that?
Well, I don't know, but like I said, why do you think I made the statement in jest, but it had some reality to it, when I said I wanted to run, but I wanted Howard Stern as my running mate?
Yeah, so they never want to kill you to not make the president Howard Stern.
Exactly.
I get it. This makes it more palatable for the establishment to kill Trump, not that Pence would be involved, because they want to put Pence in. Just like Reagan got shot, you know, the day after.
If they get their guy a heartbeat away, and he's the loyal old, to bring, you know, of the old guard of the corporate Republicans that, you know, that Trump is dislodging, hey, Donald's only one guy. See, that's why Trump would have been better off to take me, because they would want him way more than me.
No, I hear you. Absolutely. You would have been a great choice.
And I say that, you laugh about it, but this is the most power game in the world we're talking here. And you don't think people will take drastic measures if they feel the times are drastic? They will.
That is an amazing point you just raised. Okay, in your gut, if you're sitting around the dinner table with your wife talking about, you know, Jesse, who do you think is going to win the election? What do you tell her?
Right now, I don't know. Because as I said, the two major candidates, their negatives are so high, and now they claim they're running even. Which way the wind blows, a couple things will come into play. If women decide ultimately they want a woman president, Hillary wins. If that comes into play for whatever reason.
Sure. What do you make? I agree. What do you make of Trump not going with the gimmick of a woman?
Of not doing what?
I mean, I think it would have been a plus. There's a lot of able women. I'm actually surprised. If I was Trump, I probably would have gone with a woman.
Yeah, but wouldn't that look like what you're doing?
Yeah, but I mean, if it's a qualified person, then what does it matter?
I don't know.
Well, Hillary's saying Elizabeth Warren, where it's all women, so it's total gimmick.
You know? Well, you know, and she hasn't picked Elizabeth Warren yet.
Let me ask you this. Don't you think Hillary's a lot worse than Donald Trump?
Do I think Hillary's worse than Donald Trump?
Yeah.
To be honest, here's the problem. As an individual, Donald probably isn't as bad as an individual. But what I worry about are the parties. And I don't care what you say, I fear the Republicans more than I do the Democrats. And so if the Republicans have the power, that means Republican things are going to get implemented, which means what? Women won't be allowed abortions anymore? And things of that nature, gay rights, gay people can't get married now because the Repubs are back in charge. So when it comes to that, as individuals, but the fear I have is the parties run the operation no matter what, especially if Donald, gives in and picks a party solid guy to unite them, well, then they're going to get their influence back.
Well, let's talk about that. I mean, you were the populist dark horse that got into Minnesota and the model for Schwarzenegger and everything else. And, I mean, what was it like? I mean, you talked about first week there, the CIA comes to visit you. You might, tell folks that story again. I mean, because you've been there. What is it like even at a state level with the bureaucracy when it shows up and tells you who's boss?
Well, they don't really tell you who's boss. What you've got to do, you've got to create the main people around you. You have to trust explicitly that they are loyal to your agenda. And not to any, and they're not being influenced by any other agenda. And that's what I fear in the case of Trump. He's a Republican. So the Republicans are going to get their foothold in there. They're going to get their people onto the inside, maybe as a chief of staff or an assistant to this or that. And see, that's the part you got to worry about. Your most loyal people that you count on one hand had better completely be from your corner. And not be coming in with an ulterior motive.
Well, that's right. Even if you're running a media organization or a business or a company, your biggest issue is your lieutenants going out on their own agendas.
Right. And you want their you have to have their loyalty. Have to. And it ain't going to come from the political party, the established party, because the established party's loyalty is to the established party. Not to you. It was interesting. When I became governor, I didn't hire hardly anybody from the Independence Party, and I told them point blank. I said, if you elected me thinking you were going to get a job at the Capitol, you were on board for the wrong reason. I will be hiring the best people to do the job at the Capitol, and politics will not come into play on that aspect. And I took a lot of heat from my own party because of that. Because so many people think when you win, ooh, I helped, now I get this cushy job. Well, with me, not unless you're qualified to do that cushy job.
Jesse Ventura's our guest.
Well, it's like George Bush when he put his buddy who ran the American Arabian Club for Horses or something in charge of FEMA. Remember, Brownie, you're doing a hell of a job.
Well, yeah.
Well, there's your example. He puts a guy who ain't even qualified and don't know nothing about it in charge of the military. Another good example, Dick Cheney. Never served a day, got 5 deferments, yet he's made Secretary of Defense.
Well, that's a neocon thing where everybody has to be a chicken hawk. You're not in the club unless you're a chicken hawk.
Well, whatever. But, I mean, see, that's where I was different, and that's where Donald has to maintain his integrity. Keep his original people who believed in what he was doing intact, who are loyal to him. Because if he lets the party get the foothold in there...
No, I totally agree. This Pence thing is not good. But, I mean, compared to Gingrich, I mean, if he'd have done Gingrich, it'd have been some... I was attending.
I heard the general would have been a great pick, but they didn't like it because he was too socially liberal.
I know, which I thought would have been a good move to actually...
Oh, I thought that was the best move he could do. That would be the way he'd get some of the Sanders people.
And Flynn has a lot of integrity. He's the guy that exposed that Obama and everybody's running Al-Qaeda and ISIS.
There you go. I would have, had I been Trump, he would have been my choice. Not any of these other old parties.
Well, the left was scared of him. They kind of exaggerated some of the more liberal things, but he is more quasi that way. But, I mean, Flynn's just really, I looked at his whole history. He has really, he got fired by Obama for, wanting to not back ISIS. And really, he's done a lot of great work and is a patriot. You can look at him, though. I mean, he's not an egomaniac, crazy person. I mean, I'll be honest, Jesse. I'm hanging around you, totally normal guy, just a real person. I've been around, at rallies and stuff. I've covered Hillary. You just see her in person. She looks like a rubber, like, Joker creature or something. And of course, her actions are evil. But, I mean, just the way she looks, she's scary to me. I mean, I'll be honest. I'm voting for Trump just because Hillary scares me. And, by the way, you say you like the Russians. The Russian government officially tries to not get involved in our politics, but they say we're scared of Hillary, and Trump is the clear, better choice for Russia, just so you know.
Yeah, but you know what? Maybe, but... I still won't go as far as to vote for those parties. That's why I'll differ from you to the very end. I'm voting for supporting Gary Johnson, who will get us out of the wars and will end the war on drugs. Those are two.
You know, I know Gary Johnson. I know you know him, too. He's been on the show a lot. I've been around him in person quite a bit. And, man, I just, it's like you're talking to a frickin' brick wall or a robot or something, man. Not an evil robot, but a robot. I like people that are real, Jesse. Like, I mean,
well,
you know Gary.
I understand that. See, the difference between, and it's sad, the difference between Gary and I, if I would have did it, I have something that is required, I believe, Alex. And you know what that something is? It's called charisma.
That's exactly. Yeah, he doesn't have it.
Yeah, and unfortunately, Gary is not a person that walks around with great charisma. And it shouldn't be. It shouldn't matter, but unfortunately it does. But I will still vote for him because I ain't voting.
Sure, I'll be honest. I don't trust somebody who doesn't have charisma. And Hillary doesn't have it. She has, like, the opposite of it. You have it. I have it, obviously. Trump's got it. I just, if you don't have charisma, just get the hell away from me. It's who I am. A woman can be the most beautiful woman in the world. She doesn't have charisma, she's uglier than hell to me. A woman isn't even that good looking, she's got charisma. Baby, that is sexy. Final segment with Jesse Ventura. I was just talking about Black Lives Matter with Governor Ventura, and we'll get into that in another interview, but he was just talking about this Minnesota case where the guy had a concealed carry. He had a job for many years as a manager, wasn't a bad guy, and the cops pull him over, get him out, and do shoot him in the back four times because they see a gun, which he told them, I have a gun. That's when they flip out. So there are bad cops. It does go on. My point is the globalists are manipulating that to cause a civil war to get us all fighting with each other, but I want to get into your book, but 60 seconds on the whole Black Lives Matter thing, Governor.
Well, you know, I can only tell you this. When I was governor, we commissioned a big study in Minnesota with like 60 of our police forces on traffic stops. And it came back overwhelmingly blacks get stopped more, even though in comparison to the number of drivers, overwhelmingly they're patted down more. But here was the shocker. Overwhelmingly, the white people are caught with the contraband more so than the blacks.
Interesting.
Isn't that something? The blacks get patted down more, they get pulled over more, but the whites are carrying contraband at a much higher level than the blacks do, because maybe the blacks know they're going to get patted down if they get pulled over.
I was about to say, the New York Times had a big study showing that they're not actually shooting more blacks on average than whites, but they are pulling them over and patting them down and violating their rights more often. And it is a problem. It's all part of the paranoid culture. I'm just saying this whole Black Lives Matter going out and shooting innocent cops, that's only going to make the cops more paranoid.
Alex, let me interject, too. It's all part of the war on drugs because they pull people over predominantly in the poorer neighborhoods trying to ultimately find drugs because then they profit from it.
I worked in a bad neighborhood at a small animal that was a large animal vet later when I was in high school. And I probably got pulled over 10 times because it was in that neighborhood. Believe me, I know. And it was just that really was the neighborhood.
They profit from it because if they bust you for drugs, they get to keep your car. They get to do all this stuff that should be against the Constitution. They have no right to take people's personal property.
Look, I totally disagree with the police state. I totally agree. I'm just trying to stop a civil war, but I totally agree with you. Jesse Ventura is our guest. SH, you know what, T, politicians say. Amazing book. I've already been scanning through it. We're almost out of time, but some of these crazy quotes. Which one do you think is the craziest?
Well, for me, it's the one George Bush said, because, you know, I did the conspiracy theory show, and the one where he said, I'll be long gone before some smart person ever figures out what happened inside this Oval Office. Now, Alex, is that a confession?
Yeah, it's just bizarre. He's mentally ill.
No, I mean, and then another one of my favorites, so we're fair, was Al Gore. A zebra does not change its spots.
What about this one? Death has a tendency to encourage a depressing view of war.
Yeah, that was Donald Rumsfeld.
The concept of global warming was created by and for the Chinese in order to make the U.S. manufacturing non-competitive. I disagree with you. That is dead on, Jesse. I think that's dead on with more the globalists, not so much the Chinese.
What, do you think climate change is not real?
Well, certainly climate change is always going on, but I'm saying the whole hype deal about carbon taxes. He should have said carbon taxes.
Okay, well, whatever.
What are some of the other good ones? I mean, this is a book you hardly can put down. I just got
it
this morning.
It's a fun book, and it'll also make you angry. And I think the thing, I'll tell you the thing that was interesting in researching the book, Alex, quickly. I can't believe what our founding fathers said about each other. Oh, man, John Adams doesn't have anything good to say about George Washington, and he has bitter with Thomas Jefferson. And yet, if these things said are as bad as you can imagine, and yet and they weren't singing Kumbaya by the fire, and yet they still got together and managed to create this great nation with the Constitution and the Bill of Rights.
I've read all your books. They're all excellent. I am going to read this over and over again. This is the kind of thing you put on the coffee table. Everybody should get the book at Amazon.com, you name it. Jesse Ventura, S-H-you-know-what-T, politicians say. Let me say bye to you during the break. David Knight's coming up. Jesse Ventura, thanks for joining us. I'm Alex Jones with Infowars.com. Be back this Sunday. Well, David Knight will be. Then it's Cleveland. I was talking to Jesse Ventura during the break, and he said, man, be careful in Cleveland. He said, wow. All the word is, it is going to be a 15-range circus. And, you know, it's something I got to do because most people won't even get politically involved. They won't even go and speak out. They won't even, in my life, I'm there for my children. I'm the person that takes care of them. It's me. And I'm the guy that runs this operation, and all this means a lot to me. But at the same time, with great power comes great responsibility, and you have to metaphysically put your skin on a routine basis in the arena and not just be a pundit. And that brings me back to that Teddy Roosevelt quote about the man in the arena. Forget about the person that sits up in the bleachers bitching and complaining and, you know, saying how the great men could have done something better or where they stumbled. Well, you better believe I stumble all the time, but I'm moving forward. And David Knight's going to be going also up to the Democrat situation in Philadelphia. He's already been up there with Jakari before. That when the Pope was there, that place is a circus. And it's just something you have to do because we don't have a future if we don't engage the globals. You're saying it's a big ISIS Al-Qaeda target. I'm not scared of an individual ISIS Al-Qaeda attack. I'm scared of us capitulating to it and allowing the type of censorship. I want to go to David Knight here. David, what is it like for you? Because it's so surreal for me to see our anti-Hillary airplane censored twice, unprecedented exclusion zones, to see them blocking us on Facebook, even saying radical Islam. You just can't even type it in. We show it. No one cares. Mainstream media running around saying, I got crazy guy in a truck, CNN, New York Times, hundreds of publications. They're just, and instead the French prime minister and people, not just the press, are saying, good, we need to accept this. And let jihadis in. That's actual quote today. The Stockholm syndrome weirdness is getting so crazy. You see the concerted effort. What type of elite that already run everything want to break up our families, bankrupt us, and then bring in whacked out radical Islamicists? It just doesn't compute until you realize it's pure evil we're dealing with.
Yeah, Alex, I was talking to Darren McBreen about that excellent report that he and Rob Jacobson did yesterday about what Facebook was doing to not only censor, but to alter the idea, you know, to say, no, you can't say Muslim terrorists. You must say Muslims are not terrorists. They only give you a multiple choice. They don't allow you to freely enter in tags. And that's what people were not understanding. A lot of people said, well, I can type in Muslim terrorists. It's like, no. These are the tags that you don't see that allow people to find what you're putting up there. But of course, when I was talking to Darren, he said, remember that they had the open mic and they caught Zuckerberg talking to Merkel. And she said, we need to cut down on people, you know, saying certain things because I've got that covered. And then they shut off the mic on that. Now, you're talking about what kind of people do this. I've got some stories here I want to tell people about. You know, just before all this stuff happened, a story broke out about Francois Hollander, the French president. The fact that he's spending $11,000 a month on his hair. That's more than three times what the average French person makes each month, okay? He's spending that much just to have his hair done, you know, because he's worth it. And it really
another classic socialist with red carpets,
yeah.
Everybody else's money, yeah. Never worked a day in his life, bringing in the Islamics, and he's just a giant sack of you-know-what.
Yeah, it's irony that he did this on Bastille Day, right? We had Marie Antoinette say, let them eat cake. I guess she say, he's saying, let them eat pomade. This is the arrogance that's gone full circle. And so we're going to talk about that when we come
back. All right, I'm going to come back, and I got a few more words. I'm going to hand the baton to David Knight. And there's so much more, but I tell you, a great job of the crew up here late last night with 2 hours of live coverage and more. And the nightly news is coming up tonight again, 7 o'clock Central. Please spread the word about this broadcast. You're trying to censor it because it's coffin nails of the enemy. And the big dog's going to run over hundreds of you with a truck. And the media and the government aren't going to say it's part of an Islamic attack. Wow. They're going to arrest you if you do in France or Germany. They're going to take down your Facebook channel if you say it here. Wow. Wow. What does that say just about everything outside of what's happening with Islam? Again, I'm going to Cleveland. It's historic. It's important. There have been attempts. They've tried to steal the delegates from Trump. They tried to sell it like it was a normal idea. That failed. It worked with Hillary because of how sheep-like their constituents are. This Governor Pence is not the worst choice. He's not the best choice. Way better than Gingrich, but that isn't saying much. He's kind of an establishment Republican, but good with the evangelicals. Supported NAFTA and GATT, you name it. I'm told you're going to hear him recanting that, explaining his real positions the next day or two. $300 million, a little bird told me. It was $100 million, then $200 million, then $300 million. $300 million was offered a few days ago by Adelson, who admittedly offered $100 million to Trump if he would take Gingrich. And whereas I'm not against Israel, we shouldn't have Israel running the president, you know, openly here, and it's just financing it and doing it, I mean, or the communist Chinese or anybody else. So that's what happened with that little situation there. All I know is we're committed to this fight. We've proven we're committed. I think everybody should just step back and realize how historic the InfoWar is, not from some perspective of a power trip. I'm a very humble person, but all of you have really carried the ball over the goal line. You have spread the word. You have done the research. You've taken the action. Our crew, the supporters, this is historic. And so we've got to recognize just how important the InfoWar is. We've got to recognize how far we've come and how far we're going to go. I'm not here just as a cheerleader. Just to be a cheerleader for cheerleader's sake. I'm here to tell you, resistance is victory, knowing we carry the light of liberty in our hearts, knowing that God's on our side, knowing that for all of this country's problems, we were the greatest expression of the Enlightenment and the Renaissance and human empowerment and true liberalism, and that we are countering a technocratic system that the globalists believe is going to save them. Being able to edit our posts and block us and internet IDs and what Facebook and everybody are doing. And controlling language and having the sellout corporate media never say a Muslim's involved in a terror attack. But that's only discrediting them and having everyone leave them. So don't think they're the only power in the universe. I've noticed that evil people, sociopaths, psychopaths, control freaks, they always think they're invincible. They always are just super confident. They're also very fearful, though, of the general public. But when it comes to their plans, they're megalomaniacs. And so the wicked flee when none pursue, but also they think they're invincible at some point. I get more humble as we become more effective, as we change the narrative, as we turn the tide. And make no mistake, InfoWars.com, DrudgeReport.com, I mean, there's not many other places that are able to really change the narrative. Get people thinking, and we're doing it more and more. Fox, I talked to several Fox News insiders last month. I just wanted to get this out before I left town, and it's not just gossip about Fox. It's part of what's happening in the season of evil. And then I talked to some other folks about it this morning, and they could confirm what I was saying, that, you know, there's this sexual harassment investigation of Roger Ailes that started Modern Talk Radio and Rush Limbaugh and Fox News 20 years ago, Limbaugh 30 years ago. 28 years ago, whatever the numbers are, and that Murdoch's kind of out of it now, and that his kids are basically globalist, quote, liberals. I mean, look at their normal TV shows. Of course they are. And that they're not just going to control conservatives now with fake conservative Fox News. They're getting ready in the very near future, they've said this, to go basically pro-Hillary, pro-New World Order. And Hannity's going to be gone, all of them. Because Hannity's not going to play ball so much. Obviously, people like O'Reilly will, But it just shows that even the old mainline Republican guard, who aren't perfect but weren't out to destroy the country and aren't communist, they're gone. Ailes is being pushed out. Big changes are happening. The censorship is here, like Matt Drudge said, like a Supreme Court justice told him. Supreme Court justices are dying. I mean, the enemy is moving, is all I can tell you. And it's a scary thought to look at the metrics and the numbers, and I don't want to be arrogant about it, because there's a prestige factor and all the big glitz and the glamour and all the shows together and people repeating it. But to know that InfoWars and our platforms are overall reaching 30, 40%, maybe more of what Fox News reaches, and we're growing and they're going to decline. You see, the Murdochs know that when they strangle Fox News in the crib, it's going to hurt their viewers. They don't care. They've got a larger mission. They're partially owned by the Saudis. They're, again, merging with the enemy. But to know that then InfoWars and others are going to get that audience, well, the globalists aren't going to let that happen. They're going to try to internet kill switch, false flag, censorship, talk radio. They're coming after Drudge. They're coming after World Net Daily. They're coming after the Daily Caller and Breitbart. Not that any of us are perfect or have all the answers. It's just that we're anti-globalist. We're Americana. We believe in the Second Amendment. We believe in pro-life. We believe in sovereignty. You know, we believe the president isn't a god. At least some of those websites like Breitbart believe that when Obama's in. I mean, I'll believe that if Trump's in or Hillary. It's just really big historic stuff's happening. I don't have words to describe how historic things are right now. And we just have to be part of it. And we have to be hard-nosed about it and just do what's right and not compromise. And I'm telling you, we'll come through this storm. If we cower, if we compromise, if we give in fear, it's game over. Trump is a symbol of populism. Just like Nigel Farage was. He had some people in his leadership that were, you know, like a Pence character. Do we judge Farage as he had some establishment guys in his campaign? No. I think we give Trump some breathing room on this. And as long as he delivers against political correctness, gun grabbing, open borders, NAFTA and GATT and things like that. I was talking to folks the other day. I said, listen, this Pence thing isn't that bad. I expected more compromise, you know, even like Reagan did. But if he ever does something like back TPP or anything else, then I will go for the impeachment of Donald Trump. And the person said, I will too. Absolutely. So I think it comes down to that. But everything doesn't ride on Trump. But right now, he's the carrier wave or the juggernaut ramming down the enemy fortress that we're going to pour in behind. So if Trump's using us, we're using him. And I think he knows that. And I'm telling you, he's smart. He wouldn't be doing something this big with the rhetoric he's putting out if he wasn't trying to go all the way and wasn't the real deal. Because let me tell you, you don't say the stuff he said and put it back in the bottle. He's done irrevocable harm to their system, just as the Brexit has, just as Nigel Farage has. I mean, you know that airplane, somebody took control of it and flipped it and tried to kill Farage. The pilot's a vegetable. I mean, folks, this, let me tell you, there's a good chance you're going to see Donald Trump gunned down. And that's going to be the false flag to bring this whole country into martial law. There's so many angles right now. So I'm going to sit back and watch. But all I know is this. We need your prayers. We need your support. We need you to spread the word and not take this broadcast for granted. I know you're not. We had millions of new people tuning in last night to the Nightly News. Millions. Top CNN shows have 500,000. We had millions. Millions. And again, my ego, millions, millions. It shows that these people are nothing. They're paper tigers. They're facades. So I need you to go get Hillary for Prison shirts. I need you to go buy X2. I need you to go buy Brain Force. I need you to go get Supermel Vitality. It's incredible stuff. I need you to get the Natural Defense. I need you to get DNA Force, 25% off. And that special's run until next week or until it sells out. It's pretty close to doing it because it's already so low at its regular price. 25% off is true nutraceutical with nerve regrowth and so much more. Detoxifying your cells, the ultimate detox, really. DNA Force and so many other products at InfoWarsLife.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139, 888-253-3139. And get a PrisonPlanet.tv membership, whatever you do, it's important. But this is an information war. We're not robbing banks to fund this revolution. We're not running sex slaves like ISIS for their revolution because we're not revolutionaries. The revolution was the Renaissance. We already had the success. We're trying to simply restore free will and let people know what real freedom is and to take the blinders off. But it takes energy. And what is money? Money is a symbol of energy of work you've done that you send to us, and then we, under universal law, send you back products that we know you need, that I believe for the money you pay delivers way more life, way more energy, way more calories, way more support than what you've even given us. Then we take that symbol of energy and put it in to run a media operation to focus thought against the enemy in the information war. And so it's a big cyclotronic engine that we're building, and our mass is expanding, and I am attempting to go to the next level to really make a run at the enemy. And let me tell you this, I am for real, and I will go all the way to the end, whatever the cost may be, to quote Churchill. I will defend my family. And that means not sitting back and waiting for others to do it. It means going in. And that's why we're going to win in the end, no matter what happens to me individual. Because I'll explain this to quote Star Wars Episode 4. He says, well, that's true. Don't let him escape. Escape is not our plan. The globalists are going to have to face us alone. David Knight.
That's absolutely right. You know, when we look at the solutions that Hillary is offering us in the wake of this, she's come out before saying that every time there's a terrorist attack, she wants to step up the surveillance state. And she's come back to say that again. She's now saying, well, we need an intelligence surge. I think that's a good description of what happened with her private email server. It was an intelligence surge for the other side. That's where we saw the intelligence surging out of this country. Now, when we come back, I'm going to talk about what happened in France in light of the French Revolution. You know, they were celebrating Bastille Day. And I think there's a lesson to be learned from the arrogance of France's president there, as well as the hypocrisy of what he was doing on Bastille Day. And we're going to take a look at the true tragedy, the individual stories that haven't been told. You know, a million is a statistic, but one person's... Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host for the rest of this hour, this fourth hour. You know, we've seen now Hillary Clinton's response to all this, and it's that she thinks that we need an intelligence surge. As I said before, that's what we've seen with her. Every time we have an attack, remember back in March, I think it was, the Brussels attacks, okay? She called for more surveillance then. You go back and look at every time there's an attack. She wants to increase the police state, the surveillance state. That's her response to everything. And, of course, where is the press pointing out the hypocrisy of this person saying, well, you know, we need to have more intelligence. We need to be smarter in the way we approach this. Where they, this is the person who put the most highly classified documents in our government on display for everyone to get in her unsecure private server. And, of course, that's had a real cost for her. It's been pointed out in this AP story. Hillary Clinton enters the summer damaged by perception she violated the law by using a private email system. Perceptions? It's not perceptions, AP. That was the profession of the FBI director. Okay? And as one guy says later on in that same story, they talked to a 57-year-old Republican. He says, well, she's innocent until proven guilty. But to me, the FBI director called her guilty and then gave her a pass. That's exactly how that was my reaction to it when I was watching it with my wife. I said, I can't believe this. I didn't think he was going to do anything to Hillary. And here he is. He's admitting that she committed hundreds of felony charges here, that she sent and received classified emails on her personal server. And then he goes on to say, well, that's okay. We're not, nobody in their right mind would prosecute her because, you know, she's a Clinton, and we know what happens to people when you come after Clintons, right? But then he goes on to say, don't you try this at home. And you know what? This is the problem. They say that on the Hill, they say Democrats are freaked out about these polls and private meetings. We've heard in the past couple of weeks, you know, this is the never Trump narrative. They were all saying, well, you know, we just got to get Donald Trump out of the we can't have him be the nominee because it's just going to destroy our Senate candidates. It's going to destroy us down ballot. And now the Democrats are saying this. The Hill says nervous Senate Democrats raised concerns with Hillary Clinton during a private meeting on the Capitol yesterday over recent polls showing Donald Trump leading or tied in several battleground states. I said some people were freaked out. They were looking down at the polls on Real Clear Politics and asking why it was so close. She said, well, you know, there's other issues. People are unhappy and they don't trust institutions. Hillary Clinton is the very embodiment of our political institutions. She's a very embodiment of corrupt political institutions that have come to be the hallmark of the American government. For example, one of these battleground states is Florida, and they had a Quinnipiac poll that was just done, showed her behind by 4 points in Florida to Donald Trump. Now, just last month, she was ahead by 8 points, and that's a key state. There are certain states that are going to definitely go Republican. Certain states are definitely going to go Democrat. They're just, that's just baked into the way those states are. But then, of course, there are states that can go either way that have large numbers of delegates. States like Florida, Ohio, Pennsylvania, where she is not doing well. And she's not doing well nationally because of this hypocrisy. But again, an intelligence surge, talking about how we need to work with NATO. That was another thing she said yesterday. Maybe somebody should explain to her what the purpose of NATO is. NATO was a North Atlantic treaty organization. Their stated purpose was to address the threat of the Russian communists. It's one of the reasons why Donald Trump says they're obsolete. They're trying to invent a new mission for themselves. And, of course, when things get really tough, we've seen in the past that NATO was involved in the Operation Gladio in Italy, posing as Red Brigade terrorists, kidnapping the Italian Prime Minister, Aldo Moro, executing him eventually. Okay, those were NATO undercover people grabbing arms that were placed behind in case Western Europe was overrun by a rapid blitzkrieg-like Soviet invasion that never happened. But when they saw the communists moving up in the polls in Italy, they started doing their own false flag terrorist attacks. It was Gladio. You can look it up. It's a matter of record. It's not talked about much in the United States, but it's very well known in Italy. They did an investigation, and they weren't going to cover this up after a popular prime minister was kidnapped and killed. So, yeah, NATO's got a function, and but that's not really who we need to work with. I'm surprised you didn't say that that we need to ask NATO what to do, because that's what Leon Panetta, the Secretary of Defense, the CIA director that was put in by Obama, that's what he said in that famous exchange with Senator Sessions, going back and forth, saying, well, we'd talk to NATO, we'd talk to the UN, we'd talk to our other allies. And Senator Sessions says, well, you would get a vote from Congress before you would commit troops, right? No, I don't think so. Stay with us. When we come back, we're going to talk about what was behind the Bastille Day, the arrogance and the corruption of the French government and the open borders. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. Before we get back to the news, before we get back to Hillary Clinton, I want to let you know that we have DNA Force at 25% off. That's a special at InfoWarsStore.com. And also the Hillary for Prison t-shirt. Get your Hillary for Prison t-shirt, especially with these political conventions. There's going to be a lot of awareness about what's going on with the conventions. It's a great time to put that out there, and it's a great seller. And, of course, Alex is going to be using the revenue from that to get that Hillary for Prison message out at the RNC convention as well, and that's going to be happening this next week. Alex and crew is going to be heading there, so your support of our operation here with the products that we sell helps to make that happen, and we really appreciate that. It's one of the reasons we run these specials, like dropping our premier product here, DNA Force, by 25%. It's a way of saying thank you. It's a way to make it more affordable for you to try that out. And also a way to support our operation. So we hope you'll take a look at that, look at the reviews, all the clinical studies that are referenced there that involve BioPQQ. Do your own research. We can't draw the conclusions for you. The FDA won't allow us to do that, but you can do your own investigation, and you can look at what other people have said on the reviews that are there. Now, I was talking just before the break about Hillary, and her solution is more intelligence. But maybe we need to have some more intelligence about what's going on, really, at the borders. You know, Clinton has said that she wants to resettle essentially 1 million Muslim migrants during her first term. This is a math done by Breitbart. They say between 2001 and 2013, it's a 12-year period, the U.S. permanently resettled 1.5 million Muslim migrants on green cards. However, under Hillary Clinton's stated proposals, Muslim immigration would grow substantially faster, adding nearly 1 million Muslim migrants into the U.S. during her first term alone. So, in other words, three times faster than it's been going on in the last 12 years. Now, you say, well, I don't know if she would speed it up, if she'd be able to speed it up that much. Well, realize this. John Kerry was bragging on Wednesday, the day before this happened in Nice, France, the day before this terrorist event happened yesterday. So 2 days ago, John Kerry was bragging that he had increased Muslim immigration by sixfold. And so what Breitbart is saying is that Hillary Clinton will increase it by at least threefold. I think that's a very conservative estimate. As Alex was saying earlier, you know, when they tell you that they're bringing in 10,000, no, it's a lot more than that. That's just what they're telling you they're bringing in. Now, this is what John Kerry said the day before this terrorist attack yesterday. He said the Obama administration will meet its target of settling 10,000 Syrians in the U.S. by the time fiscal year 2016 ends on September 30th. Now, he announced this the night before at an end of Ramadan reception at the State Department. An end of Ramadan reception. He comes out and he says, great, we're going to bring 10,000 more of you in here. Okay, and he says, this is a different kind of immigration. This is refugee immigration, he says. It's different from the normal process of migration. It's not green cards, because I just read you this statistic about green cards, okay? That was 1.5 million coming in on green cards in 12 years, ending in 2013. But he says, no, this is different from the normal process of immigration. It's different from green cards and becoming a citizen and so forth. That's what he said. He says, it's a very different category. Here's his quote. It's different from a normal process of migration, green card, and becoming a citizen and so forth. It's a very different category, said Kerry. He also said, it's representing a sixfold increase over what we did the year before. He's so happy. Six times the number of Muslims. How many of these people have they been able to vet? Okay, let's do a little bit of math, okay, from our brilliant politicians. And you need to understand this as well. We bring in 1 million people, and only 1% of them are terrorists. How many terrorists have we brought in? 10,000. 10,000 people like that guy yesterday. You want 10,000 people like that in the United States? You know, most of these people coming in are young, healthy, strong. That's what they were saying in the town where George Clooney has his Italian mansion. They said, well, you know, we don't mind helping people, but these guys coming in here, they don't want to do any work, and they're big and strong. They're not, they don't look like refugees. You know, it's not really families that are coming in. These are big, strong guys coming in. You have to understand, this is an army that they're bringing in. This is a deliberate design of chaos that they're bringing in. And when we look at these things, these are simply statistics. Remember what Stalin said. He said, one death is a tragedy, but 1 million deaths is a statistic. Well, you know, 1 million migrants coming in who are going to kill you is just a statistic, right? Let's look at some of the specifics about the people who died, because these are personal stories. And as I read these stories, I want you to think about your future, your family's future. Are you going to be killed in a terrorist attack by maybe, you know, 1% or even 0.5%? Okay, even if they took it down to 0.1%. Let's say they vetted these people and they admit they're not vetting them at all. They're not vetting them at all. They're not even making an attempt. They don't even know how they would do that, okay? They don't know or care who these people are. They're just bringing them in and calling them refugees. First, they go to their country, drop bombs, kill people, do assassinations, blow up families, get the people good and angry, and then say, come on, let's send your young man over here, military age. Come on over, we'll call you refugees. I mean, what could possibly go wrong? They know what's going to go wrong. That's why they're doing it. They've been creating wars in countries across the world long before I was born. They'll go into a country and they will arm both sides in the war. We're seeing that happen in Syria. We see it happen in all these different places throughout the Middle East, other places as well. Understand, the people who have been doing this throughout the world are now going to be doing it here in America. Arming both sides, creating a conflict for their own purposes, to serve their own interests. So as you hear that a Texan and his 11-year-old son were on a family vacation, they decide they would go to the Riviera. They would take a European vacation to the Riviera. And they were some of the people who were killed yesterday. Is that going to be you? Is that going to be your family? More specifically, let's go back to the Bataclan massacre where they went in and attacked that movie theater. This is an exclusive from Heat Street. And they have testimony here from investigators in the Commission of Inquiry in France. And what it shows here is that the French government suppressed news that there was torture in that massacre, in that concert. This is a story that I think is up on Drudge Report. A French government committee has heard testimony suppressed by the French government at the time, not released to the media, that the killers in the Bataclan tortured their victims on the second floor of the club. Wahhabist killers, Wahhabists, the Saudis, okay? And today, we just had the 28 pages declassified. And guess what? I haven't had a chance to read this, but it's no surprise. I was told when they handed me this article that it has Prince Bandar featured in there prominently. You know, our ally, Prince Bandar. The guy who is an honorary CIA member. These are the people that we have allied with. These are the people who created the petrodollar with us. You know, when Nixon and Kissinger took us off the gold standard with Bretton Woods II, they immediately said, well, you know, we got to have something to make the currency valuable. We're not connecting it to gold anymore. The whole world had seen through the fraud. They were printing so much paper, there wasn't any way they had the gold to back it. So they just said, all right, we're going to get rid of that pretense, but we're going to come up with a different idea. We're going to back our currency by having Saudi Arabia denominate oil in American dollars. We're going to work with Saudi Arabia. Of course, they're going to buy our worthless treasury bills, give them value. They're going to buy a lot of our treasury bills. We're going to make them unbelievably rich, and then we will also arm these people, and they will support us by making our fiat currency the world reserve currency. And so we've been working with these Wahhabist killers in Saudi Arabia. We created them, and they are business partners with the CIA, and they didn't want this information to get out in the 9/11 report. But that's what's happening. But let me tell you what the other Wahhabist killers did, because, you know, Saudi Arabia beheads more people than ISIS does in their own country under Sharia law. But let's look at what the Wahhabist killers did in the Bataclan. They say they apparently gouged out eyes. They castrated victims. They shoved their testicles in their mouths. They may have disemboweled some poor souls. Women were stabbed in their genitals. All the torture was, victims told police, filmed for Daesh, or the Islamic State propaganda. For that reason, medics did not release the bodies of torture victims to the families, said investigators. But prosecutors, what did they tell the public and the media? The French government said these were just a rumor. They said, well, you know, we found some sharp knives there, but it was just a rumor. It was shrapnel that caused all these injuries. Now, here's some of the testimony. I want you to hear this, because I want you to understand, if we do not stop Hillary Clinton and John Kerry and this policy of bringing war into the United States by bringing in these jihadi terrorists. And as I said before, you only got 1% of the million that Hillary Clinton wants to bring in just in 4 years. Okay, that's 10,000 of these people. Let's take it down to a tenth of that, okay? Let's say that they're 99.9% vetted, okay? That 99.9% of these people are fine. Well, we get 0.1%. That's 1,000 of these people. What did they do? What did they do? I want you to think about this. This is your future. This is the future of you, of your children, of your grandchildren. If you don't stop this, I don't care if they call me a racist xenophobe who is a religious bigot. I want to tell you what these people did and why they need to have extra special permission to come here from certain countries. And I think we need to get out of their countries and stop killing them as well, okay? We need to get some of these people that are in Washington out right now. But here's what these Wahhabists did. Here's a question. This is for the information of the Commission Inquiry, they said. Can you tell us, they're talking to one of the investigators, how you learned that there had been acts of barbarism within the Bataclan? Beheadings, eviscerations, eyes gouged out. And the investigator said, well, after the assault, we were with the colleagues at the Passage Saint-Pierre, Amelot, when I saw weeping from one of the colleagues who came outside to vomit. And he told me what he had seen. And he says, acts of torture happened on the second floor. And he said, bodies have not been presented to families because there were beheaded people there. The murdered people, people who had been disemboweled. there were women who had had their genitals stabbed. And he said, all of this would have been videotaped for Daesh? And he says, I believe so. Survivors have said so. Elsewhere, the investigator says, women were sexually tortured, stabbed in their genitals, their eyes were plucked out. People were decapitated. The committee chief pressed the investigator on whether the victims were decapitated or mutilated. He stated the authorities had given out conflicting information that said the victims were merely shot or blown up. The president of the committee replied with this damning statement about one victim's father discovering the gruesome truth in their morgue. Okay, here's your tragedy, folks. This is a tragedy that awaits for you if you simply think that Hillary Clinton's 1 million migrants are helpless people who need to come in here, and it's simply a statistic. This is what the father said when he saw his son in the morgue. On the causes of the death of my son at the Forensic Institute in Paris, I was told, and what a shock it was for me at that moment, that they had cut off his testicles, had put them in his mouth, and he was disemboweled. When I saw him behind the glass, lying on the table, a white shroud covering it up to the neck, a psychologist was with me, and he said, this is the only presentable part of your son's left profile. I found he had no right eye. I made the remark. I was informed that they had punctured his eye and sliced down the right side of his face, where there was a very large hematoma that we could all see. This is the hatred that has been carefully cultivated by the CIA and our American policy, being brought home to our country without your consent, in spite of the law, without any vetting. This is the policy of Hillary Clinton. This is what is going to happen in America. That's a Heat Street exclusive. Along with other personal stories, the motorcyclist who was crushed to death trying to stop the killer truck, a German journalist who witnessed the Nice attack, said he saw a motorcyclist chasing the killer truck, okay? This is a killer truck. Again, this is AFP. They can't say the Islamic terrorist. It was a killer truck that he was chasing. And tried to enter the cabin, but fell and ended up under the wheels. The German journalist said, I stood on the balcony and suddenly a truck drove through the crowd. Surprisingly, he was driving very slowly, not fast. He drove slowly and he was being chased by a motorcyclist. The cyclist attempted to overtake the truck and even tried to open the driver's door, but he fell and he ended up under the wheels of the truck. And then he said he saw police officers open fire. I tweeted this out last night. And I said, I guess they will be saying that we need to have a ban on fully automatic trucks. They came pretty close, blaming it on the trucks and not Islam. And I also said that when they find this person, they will call him a Frenchman, not a Muslim. And they came pretty close to that as well. They call him now a French Tunisian, except that he's not really a citizen. The first papers that they showed of this guy show that he has a temporary residence, that he's just recently come over from Tunisia. But they will do anything that they can to put this out there, to blame it on the truck, for example. You know, it was back in 2006, this happened very close to my home. We used to live not too far outside of Chapel Hill, North Carolina, the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, a very, very politically correct liberal institution. I remember right after 2011, when the official story was we've been attacked by Islamic terrorists, their response was to have all incoming freshmen be required to read the Quran. That's UNC Chapel Hill. Now, 5 years later, they had Mohammad Reza Tahiri Azar, an Iranian-American, intentionally, as he later confessed, hit people with a sports utility vehicle on the campus of UNC at Chapel Hill. To avenge, this is what he said, to, quote, avenge the deaths of Muslims worldwide and to punish the United States government. No one was killed in the attack. 9 people were injured, none seriously. So he was incompetent in what he did, unlike this guy yesterday. He turned himself in. He was arrested. He wrote in a letter, I was aiming to follow in the footsteps of one of my role models, Mohammed Atta, one of the 9/11 hijackers who obtained a doctorate degree, he said. Now, they had a debate, and I remember that when this happened, there was a lot of back and forth because, you know, of course, this is UNC Chapel Hill. This is the liberals. They just cannot bring it on themselves to acknowledge this, even when the guy says this, even when he says he did it because he wants to avenge the deaths of Muslims and he wants to punish Americans. They can't call it an act of terrorism. They had a debate as to whether or not it was an act of terrorism. UNC Chancellor James Moser, I think is his name, stopped short of calling it a full-fledged act of terror. Just can't say it. Just can't say it. It's like Facebook. He's got a block. I can't say that a Muslim did an act of terror even when he said he did. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to look at the French Revolution. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I have one last segment here. I want to talk about what's going on globally, as represented by the French government in the background of Bastille Day. Of course, we have the Drudge Report link to Paul Joseph Watson's article, Media Blames a Truck and Not Terrorists or Islam for the Nice attack. You know, I guess maybe we're going to have a no drive list. And that's what I was saying. I tweeted out, I said, well, they're going to ban fully automatic trucks. And some guy came back at me and he goes, you guys sound like a bunch of ignorant, stupid cavemen. Guns, whoa, whoa, whoa. And I said, well, you realize, of course, that the attack ended when somebody used a gun on him. It was the police. Because in a slave country like France, only the police are allowed to defend against something like that. That's why it went for over a mile. Because nobody else could fight back effectively. You see that the guy tried to run up there with his motorcycle and stop this, but he couldn't. And so, you know, we look at this and we can't watch the borders, okay? We can't take somebody who has had convictions, criminal convictions, like many of these terrorists, once they're in the city, once they're in the country, we can't deport them. We can't have a first strike, you're out policy. No, we can't vet any of these people. We can't throw them out if they come here and they're criminals. And then when this happens, we have the media covering for it. As Watson points out, we got the headline from CNN, truck rams a crowd. Or the New York Times, truck attack on French crowd. CBC News says, children feared killed in Nice as truck attacks a family event. The truck attack, the truck did it. Okay, they want to make it all about the truck. Except, you know, when a car really does kill people, like with a Tesla autopilot, then they blame the people, okay? That's the insanity of this. But before I run out of time, okay, this French president, just hours before this happened, it came out that he spends $11,000 a month on his hair. $11,000 a month. This is USA Today. The socialist leader's personal stylist earned $11,000 a month. Now, per capita income in France is less than $3,500 a month. So he's making three times what the workers make. The workers. I thought the socialists cared about the workers, okay? He's got a five-year contract with his hairstylist. It began in 2012. By 2017, the French president will have shelled out $657,000, you know, because he's worth it. He's worth it. Now, remember Marie Antoinette? That's what they were celebrating, you know, Bastille Day. That was where we're told, you know, they all, the liberty-loving people in France spontaneously rose up against the tyrannical king. This is the way New American puts it. Took out his haughty wife who said, let them eat cake. Now we've got a socialist president who essentially says, let them eat pomade. That's what's going on here. So what they were celebrating yesterday was the fact that they stormed the prison, the Bastille. They took it down. And then, of course, you had a reign of terror, didn't you? They point out here, the French Revolution was not really a liberty-loving thing, but actually the fruit of decades of radical agitation. Sound familiar? Stirred up by anti-Christian, power-seeking secret societies that drank freely from the poison well of the Enlightenment, it has served as a template for every radical leftist revolution since that time. Now it's come full circle, hasn't it? Now we've got the arrogant socialist who is fawning over his hair, spending three times per capita income on his hair. And the guy's losing it, like me, okay? I'm not spending that kind of money on my hair. With radical agitation, we see that as well. That's their open borders. With policy from secret societies, they're the people who put this stuff together. And we look at the article. He comes out after this and says, well, you know, France, you're going to have to learn to live with terrorism. No, I think we need to do something about it. They say France is investigating whether a truck attacker act alone. You know, the point is he didn't act alone. He had the cooperation of Hollande, of Merkel, of the European Union, of Obama, Clinton, John Kerry. They're his associates. They're the people who brought them in, who are bringing them in by the millions. And we don't know how many. Is it 1,000? Is it 10,000? Is it 100,000? Is it just one or two or a dozen more? Stay with us tonight. InfoWars Nightly News, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.